The next item on the order paper is the motion on the draft programme for government framework 2016 to 2021. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 4 hours for this debate. The First Minister and Deputy First Minister will have 40 minutes between proposing and winding. All other speakers will have 7 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly takes note of the Draft Programme for Government Framework 2016-21, as agreed by the Executive on 26 May 2016.
I call the First Minister to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy, or Mrs. Principal Deputy Speaker, I should say. I do apologise. I beg to move. And today, being the first full plenary sitting of the new mandate, it is fitting that we should consider the draft programme for government framework, a framework which was agreed by the Executive at its very first meeting. So today is a day of firsts, and it's also a time of change. There are many new faces around the Chamber, and I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate all of the members on their election. I look forward to working with everyone in a spirit of cooperation, as together we take on the serious responsibilities, expectations and challenges that go with being a member of this Assembly. We now have a more streamlined structure with 9 departments, where there were previously 12, and of course provision for an official opposition. It is time now to move Northern Ireland forward with a completely new way of doing politics. It is time for a new, better and innovative approach. There will be no more working in silos. Instead, our 9 new departments will work together to deliver the best possible outcomes for Northern Ireland. Over the years, we have faced many significant challenges. They have been wide-ranging and encompassed many areas of life, including keeping pace with a rapidly changing global economy, improving the health of our citizens, giving our children the best possible start in life, and dealing, of course, with the hurt and pain caused by our past. If the solutions were easy, they would have been implemented long ago, and we could all sit back and put our feet up. But, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, the simple truth is that there are no easy solutions. That is why, when the parties to the Fresh Start Agreement met in autumn last year, we began to look at how we could do things better in the future, at how we could make the breakthrough on the difficult issues that have eluded previous administrations, and how we can meet the hopes and expectations of our people, who too often have felt let down by how our institutions have performed. We agreed that a new approach should identify desired societal outcomes first and look at what should be done to achieve them. This outcomes-based approach is a widely recognised model which has been used with success in other jurisdictions, including in parts of the United States, in Finland and near to home in Scotland. At its heart, an outcomes-based programme for government is designed to be, as the name suggests, focused on outcomes, not on inputs or processes. Outcomes focus means being citizens focused and evidence based. It requires a collective approach, looking to draw in all of the contributions within government and, importantly, beyond government to make the biggest and best difference possible. And it makes a real statement of shared purpose at political, administrative, and societal level. Previous programmes for government tended to focus on the things over which the executive could exercise control, and for that reason, commitments were typically expressed in terms of amounts of money to be invested or the number of projects to be run. In other words, they were based on inputs and outputs that could be measured, but with only limited scope to assess actual need and impact, or, importantly, to assess whether or not they were making any real difference. The new programme for government will be different and represents a first for Northern Ireland. We have listened to the contributions from the Carnegie UK Trust and its roundtable on wellbeing. We have been sensitive to the needs articulated by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation and the Institute for Fiscal Studies. We listened to those who represent our younger and our older generations when they asked us to address their needs. By choosing to focus on outcomes, attention will be directed on things which define whether we are progressing as a society. It points us towards actions that will reduce poverty, address inequality, boost the economy, and enliven our cultural heartbeat. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, the new programme has a relevance that stretches far beyond this new Assembly term. In addition to merely fulfilling our statutory obligations, we will in future be able to target those things that make real improvements to our quality of life. A key feature of the new programme is its dependence on collaborative working between organisations and groups across the public, voluntary and private sectors. It is also a programme in which individuals and communities can play an active part. The Executive will therefore work collectively to deliver this programme and to drive work across both departmental and sectoral boundaries. Individual ministers will play their part by overseeing their department's contribution and ensuring it is part of a joined-up effort where the focus is on the outcome and not simply on their department. As I said, no more working in silos. So turning briefly to the draft programme for government framework itself, the Executive has identified 14 strategic outcomes which, if achieved, will bring about the societal well-being it wants to see. To put it another way, what our lives feel like when, for example, good health, good education, good houses, good communities and good jobs are put together. These outcomes touch on every aspect of our government, and just to give some flavour and quoting from a few of them, they envisage us prospering through a strong, competitive and regionally balanced economy, enjoying long, healthy lives, having a safe community where we respect the law and each other, caring for others and helping those in need, giving our children the best start in life and creating a place where we want to live and work, to visit and invest. So, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I was elected on the basis of my five-point plan for Northern Ireland. It was about creating more and better jobs. It was about having a better health system and investing £1 billion over the next 5 years. It was about raising standards within our education system and ensuring that no child is left behind. It was about making sure we have a good infrastructure, both physical and digital, across Northern Ireland. And it was about creating sustainable budgets for families. I believe the outcomes in the Programme for Government framework will deliver on this plan. The 42 indicators in the Programme for Government framework will support the outcomes and are clear statements for change. Each indicator is accompanied by a measure, mostly derived from existing statistics, which will show how we are performing and where, if required, we need to take corrective action. These include things like increasing healthy life expectancy, reducing educational inequalities, improving the supply of suitable housing, increasing the proportion of people working in good jobs, reducing unemployment, reducing poverty, increasing environmental sustainability and increasing reconciliation. And again, those provide just a flavour. In the next 8 weeks, we will provide opportunities for people to have their say on the Programme for Government framework. A public consultation process has already started, and I would encourage everyone to respond and make their voice heard. Work has already commenced in departments to identify key stakeholders and partners and to put together the plans that will detail the specific programmes, projects, actions and legislative proposals needed to progress against the outcomes. The results of the initial consultation on the PFG framework will be analysed and reported to the Executive, together with any recommended changes before the end of the summer. A further public consultation on the detailed actions will then be undertaken alongside the budget during the autumn. The aim is to achieve Executive approval and Assembly endorsement to the full programme for government by the end of 2016. There will, of course, be challenges along the way, not least in coordinating the programme for government with the budget process, recognising, of course, that budgetary constraints will continue to be an issue. The programme will also need to be conjoined with a refreshed economic strategy, a new investment strategy and a social policy strategy that will clearly set out how we will tackle poverty. Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, the Programme for Government framework agreed by the Executive provides a basis for transformational change in the things that really matter. It has all of the ingredients to tackle our most intractable problems and make lives better for all. I have said this Executive will be one of delivery. I look forward to the development of the Programme for Government over the remainder of the year and to seeing its delivery over the course of this mandate. Most of all, I look forward to our Executive and indeed this Assembly working together to make a difference, to do the things we couldn't do before and to move Northern Ireland forward. So, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I commend the Programme for Government framework and I ask the Assembly to support this motion.
Call Mr Mike Nesbitt, Member of the Opposition.
Principal Deputy Speaker, thank you very much, and I thank the First Minister for the introduction to this debate. My colleague Steve Aiken made clear in opening the previous debate that this is an historic day, the first time in 44 years that the voice of official opposition has been heard in this building and in this chamber. And in opening the debate on manufacturing, I think Mr Aiken gave you a view of how positive we intend to be in bringing forward alternative ideas and strategies, because what Steve was talking about was not highlighting a sector in crisis, but rather a very important sector that could do better, and providing ways and suggestions for how that could be brought about. And now we come to the point where we are not proposing something, but reacting to something else, a programme for government framework from our executive and principal deputy speaker. I'd like to make it clear that what I would like the Ulster Unionists to be is constructive in their opposition. So that means scrutiny. And let me put it on record, scrutiny is not synonymous with criticism. Scrutiny means simply taking a detailed look at what is being proposed, in this case, a framework programme for government. And who knows? Perhaps the executive will produce something that is so good, so perfect, so well-fashioned and brilliantly communicated that we can't say a word against it. And if that is the case, be assured, where praise is due, we will not be shy in offering praise. But equally, when we believe criticism is the right way to go, we will be critical. So what do we think of the Programme for Government framework? Well, we were not involved in any of the workshops or processes that led to the publication of this document. So our reference point has to be found elsewhere. And it's in another document, the so-called Fresh Start document. And paragraph 61 refers. Principal Deputy Speaker, I will now read it into the official record. It says at 61, after the Assembly meets following an election and before the First Minister and Deputy First Minister are selected and the de Hondt process runs, representatives of the parties who are entitled to take up places in the executive and who confirm their intention to do so will meet to resolve the draft programme for government. The draft programme for government, not the draft programme for government framework. And in next steps, also in paragraph 61, it says, a programme for government framework adopting a more outcomes-based approach will be developed. Initial workshops will take place during the autumn with a view to having the framework prepared by the end of April 2016. How telling, Deputy Principal Speaker. It is clear the intention was always to have three versions or three iterations of the programme for government. First of all, a framework, then a draft programme, and then the solid state programme for government. But it was also clear that this document, the framework, was to be prepared, finished and ready for parties thinking of entering government to start the work of a draft on the 6th of May, with the 2 weeks set aside for finishing that work and producing a draft programme for government. Not this framework. This framework is document one of three. We are supposed to be at the second stage today. And perhaps, in his concluding remarks, the Deputy First Minister can make clear why they did not follow the process that they spelt out in the Fresh Start document, which he and the First Minister think is the foundation for a different and better way of doing government here on the Stormont estate. Because it is... I will certainly give way to the First Minister.
Well, I'm very glad that the member has raised this issue, because it seems to be his one big issue that he keeps mentioning time and time again. And the member has to accept that, given that he wasn't involved in the workshop processes, that the process developed during those workshops, that meant we were at the stage when he came in then after the election where we came in. So the process actually evolved from the Fresh Start Agreement, and then we got to the position we were in after the election and then he found himself in a position after one meeting that he decided he wasn't going to become involved in the programme for government discussion. So that's what happened. There's no mystery about the issue. It was very clear that during those workshops that this would be the process that would be developed, and that's how it happened.
And the member will have an extra minute.
Well, I thank the First Minister for that explanation. She has not explained why she thought that it would be possible to produce a draft programme for government before the First Minister and Deputy First Minister were selected. But as she says, we were not involved in the process. We said we would apply two tests which would decide whether we were in or out of this executive. Test one, was it a progressive programme for government? Well, we found out at that first meeting that we would not be able to answer that, because what was going to be produced at the end of the fortnight was this framework, not the draft programme for government. So that was a fail. We also wanted to know whether we thought that Sinn Féin, the DUP, really wanted the smaller parties around the table, and it was quite clear the answer to that was also no. So we are very happy in our position out of the executive and taking up the position of official opposition. Now, we have a framework going out to consultation, Principal Deputy Speaker. And we have, I think, 14 outcomes. I want to make a bet here. One of them, that we have high-quality public services. Another one, we have more people working in better jobs. That we enjoy long, healthy, active lives. I bet at the end of the consultation, nobody is going to suggest that we have low-quality public services, that we have fewer people working in better jobs, or that we enjoy shorter, less healthy and inactive lives. This is simply motherhood and apple pie, Principal Deputy Speaker. I hear the First Minister Foster, say this is about delivery, that this mandate has to be about delivery. Through you, Principal Deputy Speaker, I remind First Minister Foster and First Minister McGuinness, that's exactly what First Minister Peter Robinson said about the 2011 mandate. 2007 to 2011, in his words, was about survival, about going full term as an assembly and as an executive. But 2011 through to 2016 had to be about delivery. And it is clear from what these two First Ministers are saying that this executive did not deliver between 2011 and 2016. So while I can welcome a focus on delivery, I have to say this, Principal Deputy Speaker, we have heard it before, we will not be fooled again.
You're here.
I am calling is Mr. Christopher Stalford. As this is Mr. Christopher Stalford's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. I call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm delighted to speak in this debate on the Programme for Government framework, a document in which the Executive has outlined its priorities for moving Northern Ireland forward in the right direction. I believe, Principal Deputy Speaker, that politics is about people. It's about doing what is best for people, it's about serving people and the communities that we come from. It is about using the tools at our disposal for the betterment of all of the people. And we, in the Democratic Unionist Party, are about the business of using those tools, the tools of government, to build a better future for the people of Northern Ireland. Others have elected to down tools, and we heard some of that contribution earlier. Others have elected for the self-indulgence of opposition. And in a democracy, I respect their right so to do. But I would remind them that at the end of the 5 years, not one extra job, not one extra brick laid in terms of developing the infrastructure of this country, not one additional classroom assistant will be laid to their credit. It is the Government of Northern Ireland that is about the business of improving Northern Ireland. As this is a maiden speech, there are some customaries that have to be abided by. Firstly, I would like to place on record my thanks for the work that Mr. Jimmy Spratt undertook as an Assembly member in this place. He served his country not only as an MLA, but also as a policeman. The person who I directly succeed is, of course, Mr. Michael McGimpsey. Michael McGimpsey and I served together on the council in Belfast for 9 years. He was a formidable opponent, but I can honestly say that I don't think I ever had a cross word with him or doubted his commitment to the people that he represented. I am very proud to come from the constituency of South Belfast. It is the cultural and academic heart of Northern Ireland. Many of the leading institutions in our academic world, Queen's, of course, and in the cultural world, the Lyric Theatre, the Opera House, are all based in my constituency. But in many ways, that's a stereotype of what South Belfast is. Because the truth is, Principal Deputy Speaker, that there are many people in South Belfast who do not conform to the stereotype. Many of the communities that I have been sent here to represent have not enjoyed the benefits of the recent economic recovery and growth. I think of communities like Tochmuna, Sandy Row, Donegal Pass, Annadale, where I was born, and those people need to see the benefits of government working on their behalf in an outcome-driven way, as has been outlined by the First Minister here today. The programme for government contains no less than 42 indicators of success and 42 different measures. I am glad that they exist, that they're down in black and white, that we can be judged at the end of the 5-year term as to how we delivered on those measures. And mention has been made in terms of the content of the document. I actually think, Principal Deputy Speaker, that it's a good idea not to have a document such as this cast down like the laws of the Medes and the Persians in stone and unchangeable. And many of the key stakeholders in this process who I have spoken to have welcomed the fact that actually this is a listening government, a government that's prepared to take on board their views and hopefully reflect the changes that they want to see in the programme for government in the final draft when it is produced. That is what sensible governments do. They listen to experts in the field, they listen to key stakeholders, and then they draw their plans together. And I think, therefore, some of the language that has been used around this programme for government this programme for government framework is unnecessarily negative. Under the leadership of the executive, I believe we have a chance, a unique chance, to build a better Northern Ireland, making Northern Ireland the very best part of the very best country in the world to live. Some of the measures that have been set down have special resonance in my constituency. Particularly, I think of the need to tackle health inequalities. If one got onto a bus at the City Hall and got off in Sandy Row, the average life expectancy of the person in Sandy Row is 10 years less than the person that lives at Finnicky Crossroads. This is 2016, and that is entirely unacceptable to me as an elected representative for the people of South Belfast. The fact that there's a commitment in this document to tackling those issues is something that I think will be welcomed by my constituents. I think of education. I am very privileged and fortunate to have passed the 11 plus and went through Wellington College Belfast. South Belfast has some of the finest schools in Northern Ireland, but we must recognise the fact that too many of the young people from the working class Protestant background that I come from have been failed by the system and left behind. I don't believe that means that we should tear down that which works best. I don't believe that we should destroy the grammar schools, but I do believe, and I welcome the fact that it's in here, that there needs to be a concentrated focus on ending educational inequality. It can't be right in this day and age that so many of our young people are leaving school without even the most basic educational attainment. And so, Principal Deputy Speaker, I'm glad to support the motion that's been brought forward. I'm in politics to work for the people that sent me here. to secure the best outcomes for the constituency that I was born and reared in, and to do my best, with all colleagues here, to do my best for the people of South Belfast. Thank you.
I call Conor Murphy.
I speak primarily as the chair of the Economy Committee and then on my own individual basis. The Economy Committee was briefed last Wednesday by the Department's Permanent Secretary, and of course the programme for government was one of the key topics that was raised. And while there hasn't been sufficient time obviously for the committee to take a collective view in relation to this, or indeed in relation to the process for the draft programme for government, so I'm not in a position to provide commentary on the committee's position. But as chair, I can outline the approach that the committee will take. And there's a huge responsibility on the committee to ensure that the economy department's commitments and contributions to the programme for government reflect the pivotal nature of the role that department has to play in the step change that's necessary to build the levels of prosperity in the economy that are required to give all of the people that we represent the lives that we'd wish for them. The committee has already asked the department to set how the actions for which it's responsible in the draft framework, either directly, indirectly, or in partnership with others, how those will contribute to the strategic vision that the programme represents. And I know the committee is looking forward to engaging closely with the Economy Minister and his department to ensure that the levers and drivers available to him are fully utilised to support a programme for government that will provide the prosperity that we need in the North. The Economy Committee will also engage closely with all the stakeholder groups within the department's remit to ensure that their voices are heard in the consultation on the draft programme for government. I believe that's one of the strengths of the new approach to the programme for government, is indeed the consultation that is built into it. The committee is clear in its view that new configuration of departments must end the silos that existed previously, where the officials worked in isolation, making the joined-up cooperative partnership government that we need so much harder to achieve. The committee heard from the Permanent Secretary that the new culture within government will disrespect boundaries and overcome budget rivalry, and we obviously intend to hold him and his department, and indeed the Minister, to account in ensuring that that proposition, which has been long promised, is eventually achieved through this new approach to doing government. So the Economy Committee is up for the challenge of doing all of that, and the members will be watching to ensure that the promises of a strategic cooperative approach is realised. They also will perform our scrutiny and policy development roles to the very best of our ability to ensure that the draft programme for government emerges from the consultation as a robust and collaborative blueprint for improving the economy and the lives of our people. Speaking as a party member, as I said in my contribution, one of the key strengths of this new way of doing programme for government is indeed the consultation process that is built into it, where previously consultation was seen by very many of the stakeholders as a tick-box exercise, which was a legal requirement, a period of consultation to get through with minimal change. Now, it appears that some of those who criticise the programme for government, and I'd be keen to hear what others have to say, have offered no alternative except for those criticisms, but in fairness to them, they weren't involved in the origins of this process. But I wonder, do they simply want to go back to the old type of programme for government, where it was largely pre-cooked, and it seems to be that that was the expectation that the Leader of the Opposition had, that we would get a very largely pre-cooked programme for government, that it would go out for the normal statutory period of consultation, then come back and be with some minor amendments, as has been the case since 1998 under executives that were led indeed by the Members' Party, that we had that pre-cooked programme for government, minor amendments and put in place, and then a budget which is almost a separate type of process, which didn't align itself to that. For me, the great strength of this is that you have broad draft heads, and the people who are involved in relation to the development of that know this process, so I can take the criticism of the Leader of the Opposition in relation to that he wasn't involved. Others who were involved in that process, I find it a little strange that they have a criticism of something that they didn't object to right through its formation, but that there were broad heads of agreement, if you like, and then the people who are in the coalface of delivering that type of objective, which the Leader of the Opposition has described as motherhood and apple pie, although having read some of the party manifestos in the run-up to the last election, I would think that they were a very strong judge of motherhood and apple pie in some of the uncosted manifestos that were presented to people. But nonetheless, in this process, it allows those who are involved at a grassroots level in the coalface of delivering the type of change that collectively I think the programme for government wants to see, that they put the meat on the bones of that, if you like, and they come forward with a much greater assistance. And then, in turn, we align the budgets to meet that expectation, to meet those key delivery targets as well. And for me, this is a new way of doing it. It may prove after 5 years that it wasn't the best way of doing it, but I would like to hear from those who consider that this isn't the best way of doing things what they think it is. Are they simply arguing to go back to the old process and they think that was perfect, or have they an alternative vision that they want to offer up? I'd be interested to hear that. Another key point, I think, that which is a very welcome development is the, if you like, the balance between economic well-being and societal well-being that there is in this document. I think the placing of societal well-being at the heart of the executive and its programme for going on is a very important step, because while we obviously want to see, and particularly in my role as the chair of the Economic Committee, we want to see economic growth, we want to see a balanced regional economic growth, we want to see better jobs created and better employment opportunities for all our people, particularly for our young people. We also want to see addressed, equally important in the executive's work, that idea of societal well-being, of the people who need our assistance, the vulnerable in society, the people who depend on our services, they are also at the heart of the programme for government. So I think in those two developments, I think that this is an important new way of doing business. I look forward to hearing those who don't agree with that, the alternatives that they provide to us. But make no mistake about it, there's a programme to be done over the next 5 years. Others have left the responsibility largely to my own party and to the DUP for doing that. We must go forward in relation to that, because people who elected us to the positions we're in expect us to deliver for them and for the interests and for the communities that we represent. And that's the job of work we have here. Gur Míle Maolgad.
I call Mr. Alec Atwood.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker, and congratulate you and all the members of the House who are here today, especially the new members and especially those who are making their maiden speeches, including Mr. Stalford, who made a fine speech, and I'd expect no less. But if I could make one comment on the speech that he made, it is this, that of course he is right to assert that an opposition that is about not about creating and constructing something different is self-indulgent. I'd agree with the member in that regard. Indeed, there was a time when the DUP might have been very much in the character of that. But from our point of view, opposition is not about destroying something or demolishing something or degrading something. It is about creating and constructing something better in this place and for government in Northern Ireland for all the people. And at the same time, demanding the right to dissent, because as somebody said, there's much to dissent from. And that includes the content of some of this document. Could I secondly say to the First Minister, and perhaps today or later, we could hear more about this theme, about borrowing from the experience of other jurisdictions to inform government in this jurisdiction, not least the model of the Scottish Government. Because if the First Minister, is completely genuine about what she says is a new, better, innovative approach, then let's embrace all that is new, innovative and better from the Scottish system. Are we on the far side of this programme for government going to have a situation like Scotland, where people are seconded into government for particular bills or for particularly complex areas? Are we going to have, in this next government, a process like in Scotland, where amendments are invited into government in respect of bills very early in the legislative period in order to ensure that the external world, NGOs, business and private sector have an input in shaping the character of those legislation? And are we going to have the civil servants in Northern Ireland being told to have an open door to the external world when it comes to the shaping of government policy and practice? Because that is the paradigm shift that we're looking for. Not just an outcomes-based approach, which is a better approach. But are we going to have the paradigm shift that sees government shaped in the image of something very different from the past and more shaped in the image of what happens in Scotland, which has served our people so well?
First of all, I welcome the fact that he has, given the previous contribution from Mr. Murphy, recognised that the outcomes-based approach is absolutely the way we should be moving forward. That's the first thing. The second thing to say to him is this is exactly the sort of debate that we want to engender around doing things differently. And so officials here today will be taking a very clear note of everything that members say, and then we can discuss what has been said today as to moving things forward. So I very much welcome your speech today in terms of what's happening in Scotland, because it's something I find very interesting.
But it's been very interesting, Madam Speaker, for the last 10 years and longer. But have ministers and have parties and have governments embraced all of that which is different in order to demonstrate a paradigm shift? We'll wait and see. Of course I welcome an outcomes-based approach to government. But let's recognise what this document is. It is a hybrid document that is in part outcomes-based and part upfront commitments. The reason why the First and Deputy First Minister had to put in the foreword commitments already entered into arising from their commitment to Fresh Start is because they realised too late in the day to form an inclusive government that a programme for government that was outcome-based would say to people that it lacked ambition. And that's why you had to put in the upfront commitments arising from Fresh Start in relation to the past, in relation to institutional abuse, and not least in relation to multiple flagship projects over the north, across the north. This is a hybrid document that has outcomes based on the one hand, but upfront commitments to our people on the other. Why? Because our people wanted upfront commitments. They wanted to hear a message of ambition and leadership and scale and volume. They didn't want alone an outcomes-based approach. They wanted something greater. And that was the very argument that the SDLP made in the abortive programme for government negotiations. Let's have ambition, not just in relation to the flagship projects and much besides, but in relation to poverty, in relation to regional imbalance, and in relation to childcare. Because this document is characterised by warm words on much of that, and not much else beside. Listen to what it says in respect of poverty. It says that the commitment is going to reduce the level of poverty. We have a catastrophic situation arising in respect of child poverty that possibly could be by 2020, in real and absolute terms, over 30% and approaching 35%. What is the point in making a commitment to reduce poverty if you don't at least say what the scale of that ambition is? Because reducing poverty, without even using the word significant, Madam Speaker, might mean very little in the real world of the people in all our constituencies that are suffering because of disadvantage, discrimination, and so on and so forth. And similarly, in respect of regional imbalance, a commitment which is a good one was entered into in respect of the lifetime of this government in relation to the rollout of money for the A5. That's good. But remember the background to all of that, because there was a commitment in the last programme of government, 2011-2015, to deal with regional imbalance. And at the end of that, 5 years later, how was regional imbalance dealt with? By more warm commitments to what might happen in the future. That's why the measure of this programme for government, outcomes-based, should have been upfront commitments, so that people in the West know that it's not just going to be 9 miles of the A5 that's going to be built, but it's going to be the 50 and 60 miles that is needed to conclusively deal with the issue of regional imbalance. And finally, Madam Speaker, I'll eventually get used to the right phrasing, I apologise for that, is the issue of victims. The word victims is not mentioned at all, in relation to outcomes or indicators or measures. Can you imagine saying to the victims of the conflict and the victims of institutional abuse that that word is not even mentioned? not even mentioned. I hope that this programme for government process measures up, because it's very clear it needs to.
I call Ms. Naomi Long.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm welcoming the opportunity today to be able to speak on the Programme for Government Framework, which is now out for public consultation. I want in my remarks to focus here on the process issues without prejudice to our party's view of the content of the Programme for Government, which my colleague Stephen Farry will address in terms of the outcomes and indicators which have been proposed in the document. I want to start, perhaps unusually, from an opposition position by endorsing the process which has been adopted by the Executive in developing the Programme for Government on this occasion. It is a process which is based on best practice and is, in our view, a more coherent and a more strategic means of planning for this mandate. Whilst others have sought to dismiss the outcomes framework as simply motherhood and apple pie, we recognise that a focus on outcomes rather than activity is actually a better place to start if we want to see the lives of those we represent measurably improved during this mandate. It is possible to do much and achieve little. Activity and delivery are not the same thing. Deciding what actions you want to take before you have decided what you're trying to achieve, and then judging your performance solely by how many of those actions you're delivering, regardless of whether they're achieving real improvement for people, is a fruitless and a pointless exercise. We therefore welcome the move from departmentally driven, action-based planning towards a more strategic, outcomes-based approach. Such an approach offers the opportunity for more cross-departmental and more cross-sectoral working, better and more efficient use of resources, and by focusing on outcomes puts measurable improvement for our constituents at the heart of the process. Whether that opportunity is fully realised by the current executive is, of course, another matter entirely. The UUP have criticised this programme for being too high level, as indeed I take from Mr Atwood's remarks that he has also done, and for lacking in detail. The same party in the UUP argued for and claimed as a great achievement the inclusion of 2 weeks' negotiations which would lead to an approved programme for government. Now, I know that they barely spent 2 minutes in those negotiations, but as it happened, I would love to know exactly how much detail one would expect to be able to extract in terms of a programme for government in a 2-week period, even had the outcomes framework been agreed in advance. If they expected a detailed action plan and budget for each department to be delivered in 14 days, they are either completely delusional about how coalition negotiation works and indeed how government itself functions, or are simply being utterly disingenuous and opportunistic in their criticism of this process. I want to finish my point and then I will. Anyone with an ounce of wit would have known that at the end of 2 weeks, the programme for government draft would be high level and general. It was clear that detailed action plans for each department and the budgets attached would have to be developed through public consultation, which would take time and therefore would only realistically be available around the end of this year. And I'm happy to give way.
I thank the member for giving way. Does she not accept that in the Fresh Start Agreement at paragraph 61, it says that by the end of April there would be this document, the framework, and at the end of the 2 weeks' negotiations there would be a draft programme for government, the thing you're saying could not be done? It's
what
in the document.
Has an extra minute.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, first of all, we didn't endorse the Fresh Start Agreement, so that's an irrelevant question to ask me. And secondly, as I said in my remarks, even had we had this framework agreed, you would still not have had anything other than a very high-level document in order to consult with the public at this point in time, after 2 weeks. I firmly believe, Madam Deputy Speaker, that every party that agreed to an outcome-led approach knew that that would be the case. And no one should be ducking that fact now to play cheap politics with the process. As a party, Alliance did feed into the very early stages of that preparatory process in good faith and without prejudice to any future outcome of the elections at the end of the last executive. And indeed, there are some of the outcomes listed on that programme framework which we proposed for inclusion through our advisers, including, for example, the outcome that we are a shared society which respects diversity. Clearly, we were not involved in the more detailed development after the election which produced the various indicators and measures. Madam Deputy Speaker, the SDLP also participated in that process. Their special adviser attended the meetings where the process was agreed and had the opportunity to feed into that framework. At no point did they raise issues with the process of how the programme would be developed or with the reality that the consultation would be on a document that was always going to be high level prior to the election. Therefore, Madam Deputy Speaker, as a party, Alliance aren't getting to our feet to rubbish this process. Rather, we are going to focus our criticism and indeed our support on what is and isn't included, on the quality and efficacy of the indicators and measures which have been proposed, and in due course on the detailed action plans which will be developed to deliver the outcomes. The litmus test for the new executive and for this programme is what difficult, radical and even unpopular actions it is willing to take in order to actually achieve the outcomes. That is where the rubber hits the road in this process. That will be when it will be clear as to whether this is merely aspirational language but lacking in any substance, or whether it is backed up with genuine will and commitment to deliver real change. That is when we will know whether the parties will genuinely share power and resources between departments rather than divided up between them, as was too often characteristic of previous executives. Madam Deputy Speaker, as a party, we have major doubts about that commitment, and we are being honest about that. Having tested the leaders of this executive in the discussions which we had prior to the formation of the executive, we specifically looked to those areas which would be crucial to delivering a more joined-up approach. On such issues as the abuse of the petition of concern, which continues to block progress and reform, on the required investment in skills to grow our economy, on a commitment to integrated education, which has a transformative effect on reconciliation and community relations, on urgent action to dealing with the past and its legacy, including specific actions to tackle paramilitarism, and on addressing the financial and economic implications of living in a divided society, it was clear to us that genuine will and commitment to deliver real change was absent, as was meaningful cooperative working. Further, as Stephen Farry will set out in his remarks, the robustness of the indicators and measures are in some cases poor, not least on key issues around community relations and cohesion, sharing and integration. Those measures must be verifiable, measurable, evidence-based and meaningful, and we would question whether that is the case in quite a few. However, above all, they need to reflect ambition for this society, and they are in many cases very much lacking in that regard. None of that bodes particularly well for this programme or for this government. However, and most importantly, it does not bode well for the people we represent. Therefore, I hope that despite our reservations in the content of the document at this point, that through consultation the concerns that we have will be addressed, and we will see the delivery of progress and change which the people of Northern Ireland, quite rightly, are not just eager but now impatient to see. Thank you.
It's Pam Cameron. Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. And I rise as a member of the new Executive Committee to speak on the draft programme for government, and welcome the opportunity to speak on what is effectively the ambition that our Executive has for our society as a whole. It is important that the big issues, and let's face it, they are the day-to-day issues, the bread and butter issues, what actually affects each and every one of us on the ground issues, is looked at with a view to making life better for us all as a society. I welcome the recognition by the Executive that a different approach is needed, and that this Government needs to work across boundaries, organisations, groups and communities for the common good. Engagement with the local government, the private sector, and not forgetting the voluntary and community sectors who do so much, that engagement is absolutely vital if we are to make the improvements necessary. There is much work to be done now, with the Executive focusing on seeking views from this draft programme for government framework, which is setting the direction of travel for this establishment in this five-year term. I believe the approach of focusing on outcomes and using indicators to demonstrate the changes desired and the measures to let us know that we are succeeding is a good starting point to deliver the changes we would all like to see in Northern Ireland. So the framework sets out the direction of travel to include providing opportunity for people to have their say on the framework, engaging with the stakeholders about the actions needed to help deliver on the indicators, the building of action plans, the coordination of the programme for government with the budget process, and then finally the agreement of the programme for government along with the budget and investment and social strategies by the end of 2016. There are 14 proposed outcomes in this document, 42 indicators and measures. I note that very many issues listed in the indicators, such as reducing crime, increasing health healthy life expectancy, improving the quality of health care, improving support for adults with care needs, improving outcomes and quality of education, reducing economic inactivity, reducing poverty, increasing the competitiveness of the economy, increasing shared space, reducing reoffending, improving mental health and the supply of suitable housing. And, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, these are just some of those indicators provided within this framework, all of great importance in their own right, and I'm sure that each one of the 108 MLAs here would acknowledge as important to the vast majority of people who live in Northern Ireland. I note that the consultation on the Programme for Government framework is open for 8 weeks in total and that it closes on the 22nd of July. I hope that those interested parties, of which I am sure there are many, will take this opportunity to make their own voice heard. I also welcome the fact that an online survey is available on the website, which should provide a simple and very quick way for those who wish to respond with their views on the framework. Madam Principal, Deputy Speaker, I'm going to leave my comments at that for now and look forward to the consultation responses and indeed the outworkings of this ambitious draft programme for government framework. I support the motion. Thank you.
Éireann Saoire an Tuasal John O'Dowd. I call Mr John O'Dowd.
Can I start off my remarks by putting the programme for government into context? And it's set in a context where we continue to be overruled by a Conservative government, which is wedded to austerity. And that regardless of which political party you went round in this chamber, I suspect that every one of them would want to have more ambitious spending plans than is available to the executive currently. The executive budget has been cut year on year over this last 5 years, and for at least the next 3 years will be continued to be cut. That's the context in which this executive has to deliver its priority public services. And we have to deliver our public services. And each of the executive ministers is faced with a huge challenge within their own departments, faced with a huge challenge in terms of trying to ensure that we prioritise our spending to areas where we're going to make the most impact and change. And that's where the programme for government framework comes in to its own. It sets out a vision for the future. It sets out a pathway which we can follow, and it is asking, in the most democratic of ways, it is asking civic society, the community, trade unionists and others to become involved in that debate and help us shape our society for generations to come in the context of the financial realities in which we are working. And there will be parties in the chamber who will claim to be more opposed to austerity than others, and they will claim that they will do all sorts of things in the next 5 years. But what they have to ensure, and that is what we do, is that we change our society and we create better outcomes for our generations going into the future. I listened intently to Mr Nesbitt's contribution, and for 5 minutes we got a history lesson on his view of the Fresh Start Agreement and the events which led to him and his party walking out of the talks. I think the forward in the programme for government sets out why Mr Nesbitt and others walked out of the talks. Because when you read the second paragraph, and if I quote, "We believe a different approach is needed, and so this new approach focuses on the impact on our people rather than the actions we take within government." And this is the most difficult part for some of the parties who were previously in the executive to sign up to. "We recognise that for this to work effectively, we need a cohesive executive working to deliver for all. We also need a system of government that works across boundaries, organisations, groups and communities for the common good. But for this to work, we need a cohesive executive." So opposition within the executive was no longer going to be acceptable. So those parties who choose and have chosen to walk into opposition, from their point of view, in my opinion, they've done the right thing. Now, I'm a strong advocate of the Good Friday Agreement. I'm a strong advocate of power sharing. I'm proud to have played my part in power sharing with my unionist neighbours. I think that was an important step for this society, an important step for Republicans and unionists to take. And I think parties have an overriding obligation to live by that principle. But those parties who have walked away actually, I think, have done public service a great favour. Not because I believe they're going to form a wonderful opposition, because the opposition can't agree with the opposition. And we've noted it here today. The Irish Unionist Party can't agree with the Alliance Party, and vice versa. The SDLP can't agree with anyone. We haven't heard from the other parties yet, but I suspect it will be a mixture of all that. But what we have in front of us is a cohesive document from the executive setting out a pathway for the success of this society. And it's not going to be all a bed of roses. Because when I go back to my opening remarks, this executive is going to be dealing in a very, very difficult financial climate. There's going to have to be priority decisions made. And when people are responding to the consultation around the programme for government, we as a society and society out there has to make choices. We'll have to make decisions whether it's money for potholes or pupils, whether it's money for the health service or money for hedgerows. Because, folks, there's not enough money to go around. In the last few minutes of my contribution, last Concordia, I'll recite a wee story or a comment that was made to me by a local principal in a school. And the local principal, and I was Minister of Education at the time, was facing significant financial difficulties in his school. And on the roadways around his school, they were erecting brand new shiny lampposts and putting new lanterns up. And they all looked very well. But the principal said to me, John, the most important light we need to turn on in our society is in our pupils' heads. And the money that was spent on those lampposts and lanterns would have been much better spent in my classrooms. And I couldn't argue with them. And that's what the decisions we have to make going forward. Where is the most important places for our executive to invest in? It has to be health. It has to be education. It has to be the economy. We have to ensure that we're delivering those core public services. And other things may be relinquished because of that. Folks, if we're going to create a new beginning for new generations, then let's ensure that our programme for government turns the light on in people's heads. Street lighting can keep.
I call Mr. Philip Logan, and as this is Mr. Philip Logan's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. Mr. Philip Logan.
Thank you very much, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I rise in this chamber for my first time, as rightly said, as a representative for the people of North Antrim. I'm privileged to have been given this opportunity by those people, and I intend fully to do my best in this place to be an effective voice and be an effective representative of our people. I want to thank the people of North Antrim for electing me, for giving me this opportunity, and I will work hard to repay that. I want to also say thanks to my predecessor, David McIlveen, for the work that was done in North Antrim in the constituency, and I will work hard and build and continue to build upon that foundation that he laid out over the last 5 years. I am a member of the Executive Committee, and so I stand as well on that basis. And I want to welcome this programme for government framework. I think we have something here that is good, is forward-thinking, and it's something that we need to deliver on. I mean, we stood as a party, as the DUP, on a five-point plan, and we stood on that plan, and we need to deliver on that. People were very responsive to that. People trusted us on it, and people bought into that plan. And I'm delighted about that. I have a lot of confidence about this next 5 years that we have in government. And this programme for government sets it out very well. There are, as Christopher rightly said, 42 key indicators in there as to where we need to be. And those can be measured very successfully. And it's laid out very well. And there are a few things I want to pick up on from that. On the campaign trail in North Antrim, I'm sure you can imagine, and being from Ballymena myself, jobs were on people's lips. Ballymena and North Antrim has suffered some devastating blows over the last number of years. And I will continue to be a voice for those people and for those jobs that we have suffered. If we take a look here at the framework for government, it does talk about jobs. It talks a lot about jobs. And one of the examples here is we want to see more people working in better jobs. It is about ensuring that opportunities exist for people at all levels in our communities. And there will be a mixture of different people in this chamber today, people who have went through school and on to further education. There will be people who chose not to, and I'm one that chose to leave school and go into workplace employment. And I did well in that. I worked hard, and that suited my course. And my wife's slightly different. She went on to university and is today a school teacher. So we have that difference. And I want to make sure that there are opportunities for each and every person in terms of education to go through and to do as well as they can. But to leave school and to go on to further education, if that's what's right for them, or to go into the workplace. And it's about ensuring that opportunities exist for people to leave school, to go out and to get skills, or to go into the workplace and learn good skills that will equip them for life. I'm delighted that my colleague Simon Hamilton has been announced as the Economy Minister, and I think that's a welcome change, and the people of North Antrim will be delighted with that, because for us in North Antrim it has to be about jobs and about delivery. So thank you very much.
I call on Mrs. Jenny Palmer, and as this is Mrs. Jenny Palmer's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. Mrs. Palmer.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'm extremely proud to have been elected to the Assembly to represent the Lygon Valley constituency. I grew up there, I raised my children there. I still am a proud resident of the area, and I served for 11 years on Lisburn City Council and to the new Super Council, Lisburn and Castlereagh Super Council. In my time as a councillor, I chaired Environmental Services and Economic Development. I worked as the chair of Peace 3 and the chair of Comet Interreg in terms of delivering EU funding to communities and to business. While I have seen some excellent progress in the Lisburn and Greater Lygon Valley area over the last 18 years, it has also been the site of a number of shameful failures under the last governments. As the Ulster Unionist spokesperson for infrastructure and as a member of the official opposition, I will ensure that the government is held to account in this mandate. While I hope that we will see significant progress over the next 5 years, I am increasingly concerned that infrastructure will be a series of vanity projects and undelivered strategies. A significant cause of concern for me is the lack of meaningful targets in the programme for government. While PFG promises to connect people and opportunities through our infrastructure, an ideal we can all agree on, there is scarce detail about how this will be achieved. The PFG is so vague that the Minister could deliver only negligible improvement and technically deliver what was promised. I look forward with interest and with no small degree of trepidation to see what the Minister actually intends to deliver. As a Speaker for the Opposition, it is my role not only to critique, but to suggest that we should be doing instead. In that vein, allow me to suggest a few key projects that I am hoping the Minister and the Executive as a whole can commit to. The success of the Balmoral Show is an inspiration to the rest of the country, and the recent announcement that it is to open for 4 days in 2017 is to be welcomed and is indeed a source of immeasurable pride to my own constituency. However, the chaos surrounding the roads into the show is also a source of shame. Year after year, we read the miserable reports of traffic jams, parking bedlam, and wasted opportunities, due in no small part to the disgraceful lack of progress at the Maze site. Simply put, the infrastructure into this world-beating show and venue must be improved. Better planning of roads and targeted improvements such as M1 Balmoral Link Road could solve this issue. Additionally, any members coming via Sprucefield will be aware of the extremely poor connections to Belfast that inevitably result in long delays and tailbacks. With no progress on the Sprucefield bypass, the Knockmore Link Road is also important to the development of that area, and I am pleased that the Lisburn Castlereagh City Council have taken important steps to invest in its delivery with the department and developers. These projects are important if we ever want to spread the success of the economy beyond the Greater Belfast area. Our poor road infrastructure is discouraging investment in general, but it's hitting our outer parts of the country particularly hard. It is highly unlikely that all phases within the A5 will be completed within the timeframe and that the budget will not be spent. over £100 million will be surplus, and we must ensure that all small projects are identified to improve our road, rail and rivers network. These do not have to be multi-billion pound decade-long quagmires. With smart, targeted funding, we can drastically improve travel times. I hope the Minister can agree that progress will not be delayed due simply to the lack of interest or political will. I believe it is also vital that this government leverages the expertise and knowledge of civic society as a whole. In the Fresh Start Agreement, the two parties in government promised to deliver a compact civic advisory panel. It is utterly imperative, Mr. Speaker, or Deputy Speaker, that this forum contains experts from the world of business and infrastructure. In addition to being an excellent venue to encourage new faces into politics, this forum must also be well placed to suggest infrastructure improvements and critique the ministerial decisions. It must not become a talking shop for yes men. I hope the Executive demonstrates courage in appointing true experts who can not only advise on major projects such as the York Street Interchange and the A5-A6, but crucially who can also suggest smaller, more targeted improvements that will make a major impact. One of the improvements must be the decentralisation of government administration away from Belfast. The worrying trend in Northern Ireland of offices such as DVLA being relocated to Wales must be reversed. I want to see all departments, but in particular the Department of Infrastructure, lead the way in spreading the administration across Northern Ireland PLC. Improving internet connectivity is another key indicator in the PFG document, but again we need to see what concrete costed commitment this executive will make. We do not need to reinvent the wheel for this, Madam Speaker, though I would argue that we need a sea change from the approach of the previous executive. The Minister need look no further than my own constituency to recognise the Resurgam Trust in Lisburn for the model on how the department can foster community-led improvements to infrastructure and supporting the third sector in sustainable business. This and other projects must be allowed to develop in a sustainable way, so I am also calling for an end to the unnecessary and nerve-wracking process of annual bidding and the introduction of service-level agreements to sustain community partnerships. To conclude, Madam Speaker, I want to work in this mandate to be a constructive member of the opposition. I do not intend to be easy on the Minister or the Department, but I hope to be a source of alternative options rather than a simple critique. I do not intend, Madam Speaker, to be Mrs. No, but as certain members of the party to my left can tell you, I do not bow easily. The Minister can expect the same tenacity in my role here. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Éirim Saoirse or Linda Dillon. I now call on Linda Dillon, and as this is Linda Dillon's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. Ms Dillon is speaking in her capacity as Chair for the Committee for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Development.
As this is my maiden speech, I would like to begin by thanking the people of Mid Ulster for electing me. And as some people will know, I took over the seat that was left vacant by our Deputy First Minister, Martin McGuinness, so I have big shoes to fill, and I certainly hope that I will give them the same kind of representation that he did, because the people of Mid Ulster were very proud of him, and rightly so, in the representation that he gave in this Assembly. As Chairperson of the Committee for Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs, I have noted that there are three indicators which will fall to DERA. These are Indicator 29, increase in environmental sustainability, Indicator 36, increase household waste recycling, and Indicator 37, improve air quality. However, during a very brief discussion with the DERA Permanent Secretary and his team at the committee last week, I raised the fact that there are no specific indicators for the agriculture sector and the rural communities. DERA officials responded by indicating that the agri-food sector makes a very significant contribution to the economy and will be a key driver on the economic indicators contained in the framework, and that in terms of the needs of rural dwellers at a high level, the important outcomes such as jobs, health and the economy will impact on rural dwellers as much as on the urban dweller. The committee was also told that DERA will work with other departments in a coordinated, integrated way on the on the impact of these high-level indicators on rural dwellers, and since the introduction of the Rural Needs Act, that they now have the statutory basis to do so. However, I also noted the Act will not apply to central government until the 1st of June 2017 and to local authorities on the 1st of June 2018. So I'm looking forward to hearing from the Department on a semi-regular basis over the next few years about how this is going to happen. This new framework must be for all of our people, be they urban or rural dweller. The Programme for Government is focused on outcomes, and as it states, these are things with which people can identify, such as living longer and healthier lives or getting good jobs, which are designed to stay in place for a generation rather than a single Assembly term, and define if we are progressing as a society. Each of the indicators also has a number of measures to see if it is happening or not, and these are largely derived from existing statistics. These will show how we are performing in relation to the outcomes and will provide a basis to monitor progress and take appropriate corrective action. Some of the outcomes indicate that the level that the measurement is available in at NISRA geography urban-rural measure. So, for example, Indicator 16, which is about increasing the proportion of people in work, this indicator can be measured at both urban and rural level. And that is exactly what we want, to ensure that the opportunities for jobs and good quality jobs are available for rural dwellers as well as urban dwellers. But some of the indicators can't be measured at this level, such as Indicator 21, which is about increasing the competitiveness of the economy. It appears that it cannot be measured at urban-rural level, and yet agri-food is to be one of the key drivers for the economy. And agri-food is one of the few industries which can and is geographically spread throughout all parts. Therefore, while the new committee did not get into this level of detail with the officials at our first meeting, I expect that we will be doing so in the near future. I hope to be able to explore all of these measures and find out in detail how they will be used to ensure the outcomes and benefits of the framework are there for the farmer and the rural communities. That is all I wish to say as chairperson for ERA. As Sinn Féin spokesperson on Agriculture, Environment and Rural Affairs, I believe there needs to be a focus on Outcome 13, connecting people and opportunities through our infrastructure. It is vital in going forward to assist our businesses and communities. Rural broadband and telecommunications are causing inequalities for our rural dwellers and businesses, as they face much higher costs for a very often much poorer service provision. The proportion of premises with access to superfast broadband is 88% in urban and 37% in rural areas. That is a massive and unacceptable disparity. We are driving businesses into urban settings. This again creates inequalities for rural dwellers in gaining employment, and therefore again, the rural road network and access to good, affordable transport service is an essential outcome of the PFG. In my previous role as chairperson of Mid-Ulster District Council, I witnessed the difficulties at first hand that are being faced by businesses in rural areas trying to access good broadband provision, and it is a real challenge for us. I also witnessed that our ministers did not come forward in meeting with Mid-Ulster District Council, and I would hope that in this new, fresh start, and with the Programme for Government as its basis, that ministers will be very open to meeting with all of the 11 new super councils, because that is where our grassroots is, that is where our people are at, and the ministers need to be taking cognizance of what is happening in councils. They need to be taking cognizance of what councils are saying to them and what councils need. Thank you very much.
I call Ms. Emma Little-Pengelly.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, I rise to speak briefly to welcome the draft programme for government, and in particular to speak to and to welcome the focus on outcomes and monitoring delivery, which represents a new and innovative methodology. I know sometimes when we speak about this, it may seem that it very much sounds like civil service speak or management speak, but I think what this methodology does do is to focus on a number of key questions. Firstly, what is it that your government wants to achieve for you and why? And secondly, how well are they doing it? And I think that that clarity is very welcome as a new approach. The draft programme for government outlines some big issues facing the Northern Ireland Executive, and in fact, I think facing all of us around this chamber. Tackling poverty, reconciliation and social change, improving health and education, and growing our economy. These are indeed very significant issues. And when I was thinking about the challenge facing the Northern Ireland Executive, what came into my mind was a quote from the late and great Muhammad Ali, who sadly passed away just a few days ago. And that quote is that it is not the mountains yet to climb that bring us down, but the pebble in our shoe. And although that this could, I suppose, have relevance in terms of people's personal lives, in terms of communities, I think it's also relevant when it comes to governments and it comes to departments. I want to echo the words of the First Minister in terms of the high level of consensus there seems to be about the challenges that face us in the Northern Ireland Executive and in the Northern Ireland Assembly. And despite the billions of pounds, the consensus on what those issues are, the consensus about what those mountains are that we want to climb, we don't see the progress necessarily that we all want to see. So what are those pebbles? To me, those pebbles are, and can be, the way we do business. Shut in the old ways, the silos, inefficient and ineffective. And I know it's often said, and it's been said in this chamber before, but if we always do what we have always done, we will always get what we've always got. And that's why I warmly welcome this new innovative change within the current programme for government. The new approach was first trialled and tested within our Delivering Social Change framework within the Northern Ireland Executive. And I want to pay a tribute to the National Children's Bureau, who put in a huge amount of effort and work in terms of putting together that innovative approach through that. But what was very clear was when we looked at that agenda, it wasn't just a methodology that was suited to delivering social change. It was a methodology that was suited to delivering change right across government. And that's why I welcome the mainstreaming of this and right across all of the key issues within the programme for government. How we deliver is critical, absolutely essential to achieving what it is that we want to deliver. And therefore, I warmly welcome the new and innovative approach to making real and positive progress in agreeing our vision and in achieving our vision of building a better and brighter future for all in Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Éireann Sir Claire Hanna. I call Ms Claire Hanna.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and congratulations to you in your new role, and congratulations to all those members who have made very good maiden speeches. I was brought back briefly to Belfast City Council during Christopher's, and I'll know that he'll know that coming from that chamber and having small children, that is the first and last time for a while that you'll speak for 7 minutes without being interrupted. I'm glad, too, to have the opportunity to speak on the programme for government, which will be the guiding framework for Northern Ireland for the next 5 years, and with obviously all of us want to work. There's been a lot of prickliness by the executive parties about our decision to go into opposition, but I think we can be clear, we all live here, we use these public services, we raise our families here, and we want this to work as well. And we can be very clear, we're not going to be wreckers outside the process in opposition. We don't have a big bogeyman out the door and a hand that we're going to overplay for years, and we're not going to spend the next 5 years taking free kicks like opposition parties do in the South. We campaigned in the run-up to the election on the basis that we would use the new Fresh Start created 14-day window to get some of our ideas in there, and we stuck to that as far as possible. It became very clear very quickly that there was to be no partnership and next to no detail. I see the Alliance Party have taken some issue with our criticism of the process, so I can clarify we didn't vote for Fresh Start, so we aren't bound by that process, but by the very task of going and amending the primary legislation to provide for 14 days instead of the previous window gave a very clear indication that that was supposed to be a serious and substantial negotiation window. We, in good faith, went out and told third sector organisations to get their ideas in because this was going to be a substantial negotiation window. And as my colleague Alex Atwood has outlined, this isn't just an outcomes-based document. You see in all the PSs that have been added post the discussion document from last week, it does now suddenly mention North-South institutions, regional imbalance and investment, victims, historical abuse, the things that we were saying in the 2 weeks after the election that needed to be there and weren't. And I can see as well that the rash of private members' bills and no day name motions that have gone in the opening days of the mandate show very clearly that even members of the parties in government know that a lot of these issues aren't going to turn up in the programme. So if the issues that we raised during the negotiation and that you have now tacked on were sufficiently important, can you now help us understand why, when we asked for that detail, we were accused of prickliness and misunderstanding? the process. We're not against the concept of outcomes-based. Most people aren't. In fact, we welcome it. It's just the lack of detail coming on the back of such a poor record of delivery over the last couple of mandates. We acknowledge, too, that having a target doesn't always mean anything. The last executive had a target which it met to produce a shared future strategy, and right enough, a shared future didn't magically appear because they wrote it down. Scotland also uses the framework, and it has worked well, but with respect, this isn't Scotland. That was a one-party government who had made transparency and had made cross-cutting their political culture, and who don't have the same silo mentality and political baggage and departmental fiefdoms that this Assembly has become known for. We're certainly not against public consultation either, though you can understand people are a little bit cynical. Less than 6 months ago, in Fresh Start, you reduced the statutory minimum consultation period from 12 to 8 weeks, and we've had no update since the Stormont House talks on the Compact Advisory Panel that was to replace the civic forum model that was allowed to fall. Of course, it's useful for coalface organisations to have their opportunity to shape and refine the programme for government, but there has to be something for them to respond to. No organisation is going to disagree with a single one of the fine aspirations in this document, but we don't know what methodology is going to be used to decide which of those ideas are going to be taken and whether that's going to bring any clarity rather than just reflect the broad range of opinions that we know are out there. People aren't sure if this is just an exercise in saying, we asked your opinion, it's your programme for government in any future problems. It's also likely that in a difficult funding climate, one, a lot of organisations are going to struggle to find the resources to put together a comprehensive response. But in the culture of this executive, where much-needed social change money was siphoned off into the invite-only social investment fund, it's going to take a lot of courage for organisations to come out and say that, in fact, the Emperor isn't wearing any clothes and to point out the holes in your document. In the last mandate, a lot of themes weren't adequately progressed, and consultations and reports and workshops went into OFM, DFM, the place where ideas went to die and very little came out. The international strategy, the racial equality strategy, the sexual orientation strategy were all literally years late. Legislation passed as a result of the St Andrews Agreement in 2006 obliged the executive to produce an anti-poverty strategy, but last June, Justice Tracy found that you were in breach of that requirement, and still there's nothing included in this document. In fact, the programme... Yes, I will give way.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. In her contribution, the member mentioned the Social Investment Fund in a very critical way. The member will be aware that in our constituency, the Social Investment Fund is creating the provision in Sandy Row of an education and learning centre and in Tochmona of a day centre for children. Which of those projects does the member think should be done away with?
And the member has an extra minute.
Yes, the member does remember, because miraculously it was announced after no movement for 4 years, 10 minutes before the election. Suddenly we announced a tiny portion of that money was now going to the places. We know there is need out there, but we think that that should have been open to all of the organisations who have ideas and skills for solving problems, not special pet projects that you get a wee tap on the shoulder and you're eligible to apply for it. So looking at the last programme for government, as I say, targets don't actually always mean that you're going to do anything. I understand that almost half of the 82 pledges weren't met, despite the free year that was tacked on by the Secretary of State. Commitments to reduce child poverty, as I say, weren't met, and no strategy exists. At least you haven't done what they did in London, where when they weren't meeting their targets, they changed the target halfway through, so hopefully that doesn't happen. We missed the target to reduce serious crime, and again, this document makes no mention of the elephant in the room of paramilitarism and of organised crime. So how, without agreeing to tackle that, are you going to move it forward? You failed to develop the MLAs prison site or Desert Crate or other major projects. On the environment, the executive failed to meet its commitments to provide retrospective energy efficiency in public sector housing. And indeed, while the housing target on building new build was met, we know that that hasn't met the need that's out there. On childcare, a section of society that is crying out for support, OFM, DFM, failed to implement a childcare strategy and handed back funds that any parent who is paying out possibly more than they're earning will absolutely wince at. And you want to talk about alternatives, we've produced very comprehensive proposals and you're more than welcome to use them. Mr. Speaker, we are with the government on wanting a strong economy, a more equal society, longer lives, more fragrant flowers, tastier dinners. We're with you in all of those things. And previous speakers from executive parties have said, what's your alternative? What's your alternative? You haven't produced any detail yet. So we've heard a lot, but we've got 100 pages of rhetoric here. When we start to get some of the detail, we will give it a fair wind. The proposals that are good, we will support. But there's nothing in here on how we prepare for corporation tax, nothing on how we enhance North-South cooperation, nothing on how we get more out of devolution, nothing on how we address the mess over selection for people. Issues of identity also parked in the too high, hard pile. We look forward to seeing the detail.
Barry McElduff, Cahir Lough Coiste Educas. I call on Barry McElduff, Chair of Education Committee.
Gorama, I've got a free of Leascan Corlia, and I'm pleased to follow on from the Speaker who represented a party which was very much in the last executive. Lots of executive failings were listed there, but the member needs to be reminded that her party was very much part of the last executive. I do want to speak as Chair of the Education Committee, mostly in terms of my contribution, but obviously given the fact that Wednesday's meeting will be the second meeting of our committee, I'm not in a position to articulate an agreed committee position on the draft PFG. I do welcome references in the draft programme for government on educational improvement, references to addressing the attainment gap, improving educational quality, and of course early intervention designed to enhance life chances. I think it's worth commenting upon things that were achieved in the last executive programme for government. And one of these was, of course, in the whole area of educational attainment, educational improvement. And very often, as it is in this society, this is measured by GCSE attainment, including English and maths. And there is a debate, of course, more generally as to whether or not this is the best or most comprehensive way of assessing the impact of an educational system. But I think everybody would agree that literacy and numeracy are key to educational progress and should always be used in some ways to measure outcomes. In the past decade, I want to emphasise that we have seen a year-on-year improvement and percentage increase in the number of school leavers achieving 5 GCSEs at grades A star to C or their equivalent. In 2014-2015, the last available figures, the figure is at 81.1%. 81.1%. And when you include GCSE, English and Maths, the figure is 66%. And that does represent, for example, a significant improvement on, for example, the 2009-10 figure of 59%, just to give a measure of the progress that is being made there. And I want to take this opportunity to congratulate schools, teachers, pupils and parents, but also, and I'll probably come into my Sinn Féin MLA mode now, the Sinn Féin education ministers, who successively were the Deputy First Minister, the Principal Deputy Speaker, and Mr O'Dowd. Ministers are often faulted for perceived failings, but I want to congratulate them on the year-on-year improvement in the respect that I have mentioned. Moving back to me, Chair of Committee mode, members will generally welcome an increased focus on addressing the attainment gap in the new PFG. And this is to include some considerable emphasis on pupils who are entitled to free school meals. And it is worth noting that improvements have coincided with the inception of the signature programme and also increases in levels of free school meals entitlement in post-primary schools. So these were excellent initiatives that yielded good outcomes in respect of education. Other education-related outcomes in the draft programme for government include increasing the number of schools assessed as providing good or better learning provision. This is, of course, a logical conclusion of every school a good school policy. And also those outcomes which deal with early intervention, giving children the best possible start in life. Now, I have in mind there a particular scheme which has a disproportionately positive effect of interventions, a programme such as Sure Start. And over the period of time, it would be worth exploring whether or not even more children and families can benefit from Sure Start provision. That will be difficult because there was a recent increase in that respect, but it would be worth looking at afresh to see if we can bring more people into the Sure Start tent. I do want to praise the process as well. Some people are suggesting that it should have been all in here now in detail. I do think this is a real exercise in participative democracy, and I certainly will be encouraging sectors and communities to engage thoroughly in the weeks and months ahead. And I would agree heartily with my colleague Linda Dillon when Linda referred to rural communities suffering deprivation, not least in the matter of roads infrastructure. I mean, the condition of rural roads at this time in many constituencies is extremely bad. Poor broadband, that is blunting the effectiveness and the competitiveness of rural businesses. In the recent past, a private satellite company that is meant to fill the gaps for government and for where BT cannot reach, there has been systematic failure across Tyrone and Mid-Ulster and other places. And people are very angry at being without proper broadband for 2 and 3 weeks now. And this is dramatically affecting their business. There's a need for job creation in towns like Oma and Strabane. And I have in my left hand my priorities for the Assembly election, and I'm going to keep them very close to hand because these are a list of measures which would improve the quality of life for people in the constituency of West Tyrone. During the election campaign, I attended a MenCap hustings event and more recently a meeting with the Western Learning Disability Action Group. And something that absolutely needs to find its way into the programme for government are absolute commitments for greater support, greater respite for families and ageing parents and carers of adults who have learning disabilities, not least in the Western Health Trust area, where an underfunding of £8 million has been identified by Requia. So these are big issues. We'll hear that, I'm sure, from the sectors and the communities when they engage in a formal sense with this draft programme for government framework. It's not often I disagree with John O'Dowd. John, he gave the context of Tory cuts.
The member will bring his remarks.
Yes, I absolutely agree with that context setting, but I would disagree with John in this one respect. I want my street lights and I want the lights to go on in the heads of the children.
I call Mr. Stephen Farry.
Principal Deputy Speaker, I was always slightly alarmed there that you were cutting off Mr. McElduff prematurely there because I wanted to hear a bit more about the split in Sinn Féin over this particular issue. Just before getting into the detail of this, some references have been made to the Social Investment Fund, and at times us opposition parties may well disagree on issues, and I'll come to that shortly around our approach to this. But just in terms of the Social Investment Fund, just to follow on from the comments that were made by Claire Hannah, it is worth referencing that there's nothing that's been done through the Social Investment Fund that could not be achieved through government departments putting in place programmes on the ground. The issue sometimes seems to be about who's getting the funding as opposed to the ability of government departments to actually spend that type of money. Yep.
Member also accept that maybe is a good opportunity to reflect on some inaccuracies in the previous member's contribution about the SIF fund. That the SIF came before delivering social change. The Social Investment Fund was established under the steering group, so all groups and projects had an opportunity to put in their proposals to that. And most importantly, thirdly, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister had no role in the selection of those projects. Those projects were all decided at a local level through a local steering group.
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much. Well, certainly my view is that the governance around decision-making in the Social Investment Fund is poorer and more prone to risk than would be the case in terms of the normal processes that are run through government departments. And indeed, if there are concerns about the lack of particular attention to certain issues, that indeed can be rectified. But turning to the motion before us and indeed the framework itself, I do want to stress again, in common with my colleague Naomi Long, that we do believe that the concept itself is essential financially sound, but is still something that is clearly under development. So as such, we're keeping an open mind at this stage and withholding our final judgment until we see the detail over the course of the autumn. Clearly, as a party, we are comfortable with the general direction of travel, and given that we did participate in the early stages of this process, up to the point of the election being called, in fact, we have certainly given our implicit endorsement of the process itself. However, at no stage have we formally endorsed the content, and indeed that content was accelerated in terms of its development in the final few weeks before the election by the civil service, and also then in terms of discussions between those parties that were joining the executive in the past couple of weeks. But that said, the concept itself does make considerable sense. It is better than having an arbitrary list of actions, action points and targets that are thrown in by different government departments and may not be realised. Instead, we're having a series of high-level objectives that are set, and by definition, this will seem and come across as motherhood and apple pie at this stage, but that is in fact the nature of the process. Where the real test will come is in due course in terms of the targets that are set and how challenging those are going to be, and also the various policies and programmes and indeed resources that will be allocated to turning those targets into a reality. Indeed, there is a logic in developing the most rational policies and practices that will actually get us in the most efficient manner in terms of resources to the targets that have been set out. So while I understand sometimes the frustrations of members that certain actions are not mentioned at this stage, if this process is respected to its logical conclusion, the executive should be coming forward with the proposals that will get us to the outcome in the most effective manner. And at times, however, we may just disagree with what those may be, and indeed I suspect that there will be disagreement within the executive parties as to what those may be, but the theory itself, I do believe, remains sound. We are, however, sceptical in terms of our past experience of the executive, both from being in the executive and also from being under previous mandates in opposition, in terms of how genuine the situation will be in terms of the executive adopting the most logical approach to achieving the objectives, because far too often other considerations enter into the equation, which sometimes reflect some political realities, and that's fine. I mean, we're a political assembly, but that does, whenever that does happen, it does betray the trueness and genuineness in terms of how those targets can actually be reached. So the process can be compromised through sometimes too much of the different political considerations that will come from the different partners in government. One particular area where I do have some concern is around what has been said in relation to health. We have heard a lot of focus on the importance of setting the objectives and then following through in due course with the policies to get that outcome. But we've had the two parties within the executive both making a commitment to spending an additional £1 billion on revenue spending and health by 2021. That seems to run entirely counter to the approach that is being adopted. I'm all for spending the right amount of money on health to achieve much better outcomes. But surely the most logical thing to do is to actually put in place the reform process and to work out what we need to do to spend to achieve outcomes and also to resource that transformation, rather than saying now, making an arbitrary commitment that the round figure of additional billion will be spent by 2021. And in particular, the realisation of that outcome in the absence of other efficiencies being found. And what I mean by efficiencies is something more than simply tampering with the levels of rates exemptions or rates capping or issues in terms of abolishing a few quangos here and there. We're talking serious reform, or indeed potentially some form of revenue raising or addressing the cost of the division. In the absence of any of those, we are looking at very stringent cuts to other departments if we were to achieve that £1 billion extra for health, and that indeed would undermine a lot of the other worthy objectives in terms of this draft framework. just want to spend the balance of my time just focusing on some of the specifics that have been set out. Some of them are good and sound. For example, what we're doing around skills. I'm pleased to see that there's a recognition of the gradation in terms of skills. We're not looking at a very flat indicator. That's positive. I'm glad to see economic activity is mentioned. And indeed, the logic there is that we very efficiently implement the existing strategy that was agreed by the previous executive. But there's some other areas where I do have some concerns. First of all, if we're talking about increasing reconciliation, the theme there seems to be about people respecting different cultural traditions within society, which may well be one aspect of reconciliation. But reconciliation is also about building friendships and overcoming divisions. And it is possible that you could achieve that type of outcome through people having a better tolerance of what are sometimes activities in different parts of the community rather than a genuine coming together. So we need to be slightly careful as to exactly how that's going to be achieved. I think also we need to have some degree of concern over how far we go in terms of focusing on the regional imbalance within our economy. We do need to transform the Northern Ireland economy overall, and we do need to recognise that there are imbalances and to try to address that. But if we come almost a slave to that, we maybe end up overly micromanaging investment decisions. We maybe neglect the ability of Greater Belfast to drive our economy, not just in terms of the area around Greater Belfast, but indeed all of Northern Ireland. So there are some particular issues there that we do need to bottom through. Thank you very much, Madam Deputy Speaker.
I now call on Mr Doug Beattie, and as this is Mr Beattie's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House it's a convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. I call Mr Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. It's nice to stand up to get some blood flowing in my legs, I have to say. If I may start, please, by paying tribute to my predecessor, Sam Gardner, MBE, a one-time father of the House. His dedication to these institutions and to the people of Upper Ban, and indeed to Lurgan, is extremely well known. And I wish him all of the best for the future. But he has handed that baton on to me, and I am very mindful that I am here to represent all of the people of Upper Ban. And I must take the opportunity to thank those people for putting their faith in me and voting me to this Assembly. But it's also important, I believe, to show a fair degree of humility, because as I stand and say of all these people who voted for me, there are many, many more people who did not vote for me at all and did not give me a preference. And I will represent them just as much as I will represent anybody else in my constituency. And I will use my core values and standards which have sustained me over my whole lifetime, which is integrity, respect for others, professionalism, selfless commitment, courage, and above all, loyalty. I'm extremely proud to be once again opening a fully functioning MLA constituency office in Portadown. If I may, Principal Deputy Speaker, just take one moment out to thank all members of this Assembly for their kind words of support on the passing of my beautiful grandson, Cameron, who died at 15 months, the day before the election. Your kind words have sustained me. It remains a difficult time for me. It remains a difficult time for my family. But knowing that there are people like yourselves who gave me those kind words really have helped me. And will help me in the long term, as it will my family. As I move on to this document, Principal Deputy Speaker, I have to start by saying that I am disappointed. I am disappointed at this whimsical document on crisp white paper with no real value or intellectual currency, or in fact, its shifting responsibilities. It sets an agenda for the next 5 years, but does not give a long-term vision for Northern Ireland in the next 20 or 30 years. In fact, there may be even some people within the government who don't want to see Northern Ireland to have a long-term future in the next 20 to 30 years. So let's just drill down into it just a little bit. In fact, no, let's just scratch the surface of this document for a moment. At the heart of this document is the Fresh Start Agreement. And at the heart of the Fresh Start Agreement is tackling paramilitarism. Yet there's absolutely no mention of paramilitarism until page 29, and even then it's fleeting, with no measurable outcomes and no indicators. Let me just take from outcome 7, if I may. A safe community is one where paramilitary groups and criminal gangs cannot exert influence. So where are the indicators to address this? In fact, we, as an executive, and I've got to say, the Ulster Unionist Party were part of the executive, and we are not out of blame here, but we are sustaining paramilitarism in this country. And when we look to the future, I can see us sustaining it for another 5 years. We have semi-autonomous paramilitary wings at Her Majesty's Prison in Maghaberry. We allow that to happen. We sustain it. We give it credibility. We give it an identity. We are giving it structure. We are allowing them to direct terrorism. And if anybody thinks that is not true, then you just have to look at the brutal murders of prison officer Ismay and prison officer Black. So where are the indicators to deal with that issue, to stop the segregation and treat these people as they are, criminals, to be dealt with as criminals? But even if you come down and you look to at a small, more basic level, and we look at these illegal paramilitary parades on our streets, indeed my area of Upper Ban, Lurgan, men dressed in paramilitary uniforms, men, women and children. I commend the police office, the police service of Northern Ireland, for how they deal with them during the parade, how they deal with it after the parade. But the damage is already done, because these paramilitary parades are influencing our children. Where is the indicator to deal with that? And before some of you people sitting here roll your eyes at me on this, let me just remind you that paramilitarism affects far more of our outcomes. Our international standing, outcome 10, an effective justice system, outcome 11, division, segregation contained in outcome 12, effective and reliable public services, outcome 13, all affected by paramilitarism, yet we have not, in this document, addressed it with any indicators whatsoever. Principal Deputy Speaker, as a new MLA, I came in here and I expected and I wanted to see a programme for government that would handrail us to a brighter, long-term future. I genuinely did, and I genuinely want that. But what I got was an expensive doorstop holding closed the door to prosperity, social progress, cultural acceptance, and a normalised society, which our people deserve. Thank you.
And I'd like to thank the member for his maiden speech, and also I'd like to put on record our deep commiseration. I'm sure I speak for all the House on the loss of your beautiful grandchild. As a mam or a grandmother myself, the loss of a child is just a dreadful thing, and I'd just like to put on record our commiseration. I call Mr. Declan McAleer.
I note and welcome the draft programme of government here before today, with its 14 strategic outcomes and the indicators which are focused on societal outcomes. The fact that this is a collaborative approach, it's very important to give people their say and give them a sense of ownership, because it's their programme for government. And certainly I, along others, will be encouraging people to have their say on this developing, rolling process by the 22nd of July. Speaking from an infrastructure perspective, as a party's spokesperson on infrastructure, I welcome the fact that we do have one of the strategic outcomes dedicated to infrastructure, and indeed, as a representative from the West, and indeed the wider Northwest, the fact that regional balance is also included here as one of the strategic outcomes. And I have to also say that whilst these individually are very welcome, it's very important to point out that very good infrastructure underpins all of the 14 outcomes, indeed underpins all of the economic and social development that we have here. I welcome the fact that the programme for government gives a commitment to deliver on the flagship projects which were announced in the budget last August. And these have been identified in the new programme for government framework here before us, the BRT, the Belfast Transport Hub, the Stadia programme, the new training facilities for emergency services, and indeed the new Children's Hospital. And certainly from a North West perspective, I welcome very, very much that the commitment, the recommitment to the A5 and A6 have been included here in the programme. And that's extremely important. And it also recognises the importance of key strategic corridors like the A8, A1, M1, A4, A26, A22 as key strategic corridors. And because this is extremely important. I should also say that in the time ahead, it's important to recognise that these strategic corridors are extremely important to themselves, not just within the north, but within the wider context of the island of Ireland. These roads don't stop at the border. Indeed, the A5 is connected to the N2 at Monaghan and the N14 at Donegal. The M1 is the A4, and indeed the A4 leads on by the through the N16 onto Sligo and into the west. And this is important in the time ahead. We continue the work with the Irish government because one of the objectives of the TNT, the Trans-European Network, which is currently underway, is to reduce these bottlenecks and these linkages between different pieces of transport infrastructure. And this is something in the time ahead that we'll continue to play our part as a party with the 30 members that we have in the Oireachtas and moving this ahead. I also welcome the fact that in the document in relation to transport and infrastructure, we see reference to the commitment to the active travel, the bicycle strategy. Indeed, the Ulster Canal is also mentioned. I know this is something that my colleague Sean Lynch is very interested in, has been working at for a number of years, and we no doubt will kind of keep this very high on the agenda. So, folks, in conclusion, I welcome this new framework, this PFG framework. As my colleague from West Rome, Brian McLough, said earlier on, this is an example of participative democracy. It's a new approach which will unfold and develop and as a consultation takes place with stakeholders right across the different sectors. It sets out the direction of travel. I certainly commend the draft programme for government and I will encourage everyone to have their say in the development of this process.
Sir Mark Durkin, please.
Members will be relieved to hear that I'm not going to dwell on issues around process, our views on which have been accurately and eloquently proffered by my colleagues who have spoken already, Alex Atwood and Claire Hannah. When Mr O'Dowd spoke today, and I think he made a very good contribution to today's debate, he spoke of the challenges facing the new executive, the new ministers and their new departments. And certainly there are huge challenges, but there are also huge opportunities to do things better and to make things better for people. This document, in our belief, doesn't grasp or even attempt to grasp those opportunities. Mr Stalford, in his maiden speech, said something along the lines of, it's the business of government to improve the lives of people, and he intimated that those of us who chose not to be in government and those of us who didn't have that choice have no role to play in that. Well, we are making it our business in opposition to improve the performance of government. We have seen, and people have felt and continue to feel, the failure by government to deliver on real issues. And nowhere has this failure been more pronounced than in my own constituency. And the fig leaf that has been used to cover at least one of these failures, say, for example, the expansion of McGee and the economic and social benefits that that would undoubtedly bring, is that it was not in the programme for government. So forgive, please forgive, our concerns at the lack of specifics in this document. We can't argue with these desired outcomes. Who could? But we just want to ensure them. Last week, many members here attended an event in the Long Gallery. It was hosted by Autism NI and sponsored by Ms Cameron, and participants at that event described their frustrations and concerns at the lack of delivery by several departments and the lack of care. It was entitled Broken Promises. Well, one would get the impression from this programme for government that the executive are avoiding making promises just to avoid breaking more promises. We need more detail. How are we going to reduce health inequality? How are we going to increase the supply of suitable housing? And how are we going to afford it? How will we improve the skills profile of the population? And especially, how will we do so when we're voting through budgets that reduce the skills budget? Plans to reduce poverty are admirable, but we have, as Ms Hannah said, seen strategies come and go, and some strategies we've just waited for to come and are still waiting. I would like to have seen, in particular, more detail in this document on how we intend to improve environmental sustainability. The reduction of greenhouse gas emissions will be difficult, extremely difficult, in the context of us trying to grow our economy. And I believe that this can only be achieved through the introduction of Northern Ireland-specific climate change legislation. As my colleagues have outlined, it's our intention to work constructively inside this chamber and outside it to help deliver all these outcomes and much more. And we will continue to demand answers and demand actions to obtain tangible evidence that they are or why they aren't being delivered.
Mr. Dahi Mackay.
Alas, Can Coyer. This is my first time speaking on this new mandate, alas, Can Coyer, and we're down to sit to 9 o'clock tonight. And I'm disappointed in that because I think we're still feeling the staff in this building. It's an archaic way of doing business. It's not family friendly and it's not rural friendly. So I think as we start the business of the new assembly, alas, Can Coyer, and I know that the business office and others will be looking at this, we need to get things right from the start, because for the past 5 years we've talked about the need to attract more women into this assembly, we've talked about the need for family friendly hours, and then we're starting a new session and we haven't done anything about it. So I think that's something that should be put on the record as something that needs addressed. On the other hand, I'm glad to see that the executive will be doing business differently. This is a progressive framework, and it will help us to tackle the age-old problem of departmental silo mentality. It puts well-being at the heart of government, and health is at the forefront of this document. It talks about public health strategies, tackling health inequalities, active travel, which is a health issue in itself, childcare and mental health. And of course, all of these issues sit in different departments. And that is why we need an outcome-focused programme for government, not a departmental-focused programme for government. And I think it's only apt as well that we commend Carnegie and those involved in the round table whose work over the past 3 years, and I attended many meetings. I know that the current Minister for the Economy did the same, as did Junior Minister Fearon and David McIlveen. They no doubt contributed to this new progressive framework that we have in front of us. And it's a good thing that the public will have their say. It's a good thing that stakeholders and the community will have their say in this document to ensure that we get it right. But I think the direction of travel from the executive quite clearly is the correct one. I'm disappointed, alas, Can Coyer, that the opposition has not done its homework. I was expecting great things from the much talked about opposition, the opposition that can't decide how it's going to be an opposition between the two main parties anyway, because today was an opportunity to land a few blows on new executive, an opportunity to outline detail of their alternative programme for government framework. But there's no alternative before us. So I would say to the members to the left that there is an opportunity to feed in those views, and we want detailed proposals, not just we don't like this and we don't like that. We need detailed proposals about what their alternative programme for government framework is. And I hope that there will be a constructive opposition, as they've outlined, because all I've heard today so far is complain, complain, complain. It was said over the election that they wanted to be a constructive opposition. Well, we have yet to see that. In terms of the indicators, it is great, Alaska and Courier, that active travel has been included as one of the indicators. And that represents the crossover between both health and transport and health and infrastructure. And I do think that this needs looked at closely as part of the consultation, because coupling public transport with active transport could, I think, mean that a decrease in cycling and walking is masked by an increase in bus and train journeys. And that is something certainly that I will be putting forward as part of our response. And active transport is much more important than that. We are in a very car-centric society, and there are a lot of car-centric civil servants. That should not be allowed to cloud aspects of this programme for government and its indicators. There are a number of issues, indicators and targets in here that are very important to the rural community that I represent too. The internet connectivity, the issue that Declan McAleer has outlined in terms of travel times, all big issues for rural commuters, all big issues in terms of the health of the rural communities as well. So those are equally important. So to conclude, Alaska and Courier, and I want to come back on one point actually that Claire Hannah made about the Scottish experience, because there are parallels to ourselves here in terms of the situation with departments. Because I remember John Elveridge, who I've met on a number of occasions, outlined the fact that he knew there was going to be departmental resistance to this new situation, this new way of doing government, and he, in effect, brought it in overnight in consultation with ministers. So he knew there would be institutional resistance. He knew there would be resistance from certain parts of the civil service, and no doubt there will be resistance in terms of our own local government structures as well. So I would encourage the other parties not to just dismiss this new way of doing government, because it's bold, it's progressive, it's about doing things differently and focusing on health outcomes, on outcomes that are important to the communities we represent. We're moving away from the old way of doing business. We're moving away from the silo mentality, from the culture of fiefdoms within our departments. This is a big, big step, and I would urge the opposition not to to try and make hay out of this, but to actively respond to the consultation and ensure that we can take this step forward for the better of everybody in our communities.
I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on the issue of the Executive's draft programme for government framework, and I do so from a health perspective. A draft framework, a vague wish list to buy some time for officials to draft yet another document, which will probably only be ignored anyway. It really does make me wonder what all the meetings in the last 6 months leading up to the election were really all about. I think the very fact that the last Assembly existed without a programme for government for the 2015-2016 year demonstrated exactly how little regard the document is actually given. And as you read through it, the amateurish and unprofessional measures accompanying the health indicators will give people very little confidence at all. It would have been better to leave them out rather than rushing them in before it had to go to the printers. Targets, despite what some officials within the department and trust would say, remain important as a means to monitor and judge health performance. So from the outset, I would urge the executive to avoid being taken down the path that somehow health targets are a burden or in any way unnecessary. There are 42 indicators in the current draft PFG framework document, and only 6 of these relate to health. So I want to make some brief comments on some of those shortly. Whilst no one could disagree with any of those 6, what is more noticeable is what is not included. Mr Deputy Speaker, at a time when 376,382 people are waiting for a first outpatient appointment, diagnostic test or inpatient treatment, surely the most pressing target for the Department and the Executive collectively is to deliver timely and safe treatments for patients. And then our second key priority would be to remove the abhorrent variances in the quality of care being provided across the 5 health trusts. For instance, taking the target that 100% of patients with suspected breast cancer should be seen within 14 days. Overall, in 2015-2016, 99% were seen on time within the Western Health Trust, yet only 66% in the South Eastern Trust, and an appalling 43% in the Belfast Trust. In addition, rather than including bland indicators, such as increasing respect for each other, maybe the Executive should be placing a duty on its ministers to respect their staff. Maybe then scenes such as the Royal College of Nurses and the Royal College of Midwives threatening to take industrial action, partially as a result of sheer anger with the attitudes of the then Health Minister Simon Hamilton, could have been avoided. Also, why no indicator on committing to continually review services in order to ensure they are able to adapt to an ageing population? When it comes to reducing health inequality, we cannot forget that people who come from socially disadvantaged backgrounds are much more likely to die from heart disease and respiratory disease. Far too many of these deaths occur before the age of 65, and most are entirely preventable with only a few lifestyle changes. Smoking, an unhealthy diet, excessive alcohol consumption, and little physical activity all greatly contribute to this inequality. We delivered the creation of the PHA, despite opposition from the DUP at the time, and we will firmly oppose any measure to dissolve it, especially now after the deeply flawed and poorly handled announcement regarding the abolition of the Health and Social Care Board. I would certainly like to see a commitment from the First and Deputy First Minister for the PHA continue for the next 6 years. When we look at Indicator 4, reducing preventable deaths, there needs to be a commitment to target each of the 5 big causes of early death – cancer, stroke, heart, respiratory and liver disease. We also need to look at our ratio of intensive care beds. There could be little surprise that following the success of the Cancer Patient Experience Service in England and Wales, the PHA here, along with Macmillan Cancer Support, funded a similar survey for Northern Ireland. The 2015 Northern Ireland Cancer Patient Experience Survey covered around 5,000 adult cancer patients in Northern Ireland with the primary diagnosis of cancer, who had been inpatients or day care patients and who were receiving active treatment between 1 December 2013 and 31 May 2014. That's just one example of why Indicator 5, improving the quality of healthcare experience, is crucially important. However, in listening to patients, it's essential that the trusts are open and responsive to the concerns that will inevitably be heard. Finally, turning to Indicator 6, improving mental health, there is an ever-increasing body of evidence proving that our poor rates of mental health are directly related to our previous levels of violence. It's a legacy issue, with not only victims being affected, but the children and grandchildren of victims. We cannot ignore the staggering fact that more people have lost their lives through suicide since the Belfast Agreement than died during the entire Troubles. And this is a core issue for my party, the Ulster Unionist Party. That is why in February this year, we published a detailed policy paper dedicated to the issue and which contained 15 specific points, including ideas like a mental health champion, greater focus on prevention and detecting signals earlier, and tackling the stigma sometimes associated with poor mental health. This paper has been positively welcomed by the experts, and I will send a copy to the new Health Minister for consideration with this indicator in the PFG. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I would encourage the executive parties, when eventually considering the targets they will set up for themselves, to seek to challenge and not merely agree with the civil service, to set reasonable, tangible targets, not just accepting the low hurdles, to seek to drive forward real, lasting and important changes for our people. And this is not an easy task with civil service, which two decades on are still struggling with the post-devolution era. And I trust that the executive will do what's right for Northern Ireland. We in the opposition benches will constructively criticise when necessary.
Could the member bring her remarks to a close,
and do please. What's right for Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I call Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. Can I take this opportunity to congratulate you, I think, in your first sitting as Deputy Speaker. There has been quite a bit of talk today about process. Process leading up to this, process before the election, process from here to December, or whenever we're going to have a final draft of the programme for government. And that's all fine, and it's all important, and I'm sure we have to put it all on the record. But I think, to be honest, Mr. Deputy Speaker, the public out there are more interested in what we're actually going to do. We believe very strongly in consultation. We always do. We always argue for good consultation processes. We've just been through the best possible consultation you could ever go through. All of us sat down and worked with experts and spoke to civic society and developed manifestos, argued over them, defended them, and put them in front of the people. And then we went out, and I know personally, I consulted with thousands, probably, of people about our manifesto and our ideas and about this place and about how it works and how it doesn't work. We've been through it. It's called an election. It's called democracy. And then we had to try and form a government. The SDLP, from our perspective, went into the process to honestly get the best possible draft programme for government, even if it was a broad programme for government. That's why we met, and we're thankful for the openness in which we were met by the civil service. We met with the head of the civil service, we met with the heads and important key figures in many of the departments, and we argued and interrogated and tried to come up with the best possible solutions to some of the problems that we have based upon the work we'd already done in our manifesto. Then we put forward papers into the process where we would, with specific policies and specific ideas, and a note that Mr. Mackay wants us to come up with specific ideas. We've done it. It's all published. It's in the open. That was our approach to this process. Unfortunately, that's not where we ended up. And I must say, though, Mr. Deputy Speaker, there was one meeting that we didn't get. We didn't get a meeting with the finance department on the overall financial picture. That was the only meeting that we couldn't get. And I think, you know, we're all maybe not looking forward to, but interested in finding out why that was. What is the financial picture? How bad is it? And I think it's important that the public are given an early understanding of what the financial picture actually is. We couldn't get it in that process. So we wanted to have a programme for government, a draft programme for government. And I know the language of this is all very interesting, because many speakers, many of them from government benches today, have talked about this draft programme for government. Well, of course, this isn't the draft programme for government. This is a framework for a programme for government, or whatever the language is. Our view, Mr. Deputy Speaker, in the consultation that we had with the public, was that people aren't interested in personality clashes up here, or who's speaking to who, or who gets on well with who. What they're interested in is, when are we going to get down to the business of actually delivering? I don't think they're going to be satisfied to see that we won't even have a programme for government for another 5 or 6 months. People want to see us urgently rush towards reform and change and action and delivery. And that's what the last mandate was supposed to be about. I don't think any of us, and all of us, we were in government, and we hold our hands up to the part that we played. We tried our best with one ministry. But none of us could stand up here and say that was a mandate filled with delivery and opportunities reached and change delivered. I don't think that's what happened. So, yeah, we should consult. But we should consult with something, not just a broad wish list. That's what our manifestos were supposed to be about. They were supposed to be about policies that we could actually deliver. Then we had an election and we all accept the result of the election. So, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I think the society out there is crying out for action, not warm words. And if you look at this framework, it doesn't understand or recognise that we are facing crises on so many different fronts. We're facing a crisis on immigration. Far too many of our young people are leaving our shores to find work or to find a university place. We're facing a crisis on homelessness. In my own city, there are thousands of people on the housing waiting list. We're facing a crisis on child poverty. In Derry, North Belfast, West Belfast, parts of East Belfast, right across the north, far too many of our children are still living in far too high levels of child poverty. We're facing a crisis in waiting lists, in hospital and health waiting lists. And of course, Mr. Deputy Speaker, we are still facing a staggering level of economic inactivity in many of our areas. And bizarrely, we're facing cuts and further cuts in our university sector. So whilst this process, and we accept that this is a process now, we will positively and constructively engage in it. We will put in papers, we will respond to the consultation, we will do our best to put forward alternatives where alternatives are required. But what we'll need to see is that the people and the areas that have been left behind for far too long, that their needs are actually addressed. We need to see, in our view, a commitment to increased opportunity for childcare for hard-pressed families. We talked in our manifesto about moving from around 12 hours to 20 hours with a view later on of going to 30. We want to see targeted economic investment in those areas that have been left behind. We want to see fairness at the heart of everything this government does. We want to see support for victims. We want to see the opportunity that arises out of the potential of north-south development economically in the health service and education and tourism right across the different sectors, that opportunity is actually once and for all realised. And we need to see, finally, once and for all, infrastructure going to the west, not more warm words about it. And let me just say this, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if we don't see once and for all, after more than 50 years, investment in the university at Derry and McGee, we will not be supporting a programme for government that again fails to do that.
I call Sandra Overend.
Deputy Speaker, and may I take the opportunity to congratulate you in your new role as Deputy Speaker. I rise in order to critique the draft programme for government framework in terms of education policy as the Ulster Unionist education spokesperson. As the Ulster Unionist Party leader said, our position is to scrutinise and critique, not necessarily oppose the work of the executive, for we are happy to give support where it is deserved. Mr. Deputy Speaker, in the wake of an election when the Northern Ireland electorate was encouraged to vote for the DUP to keep Sinn Féin out of the First Minister's post, I look back and recall the plea that education also should be taken out of the hands of Sinn Féin. After 18 years of education in the hands of Sinn Féin, Northern Ireland now has a DUP education minister, albeit it now seems he has joined at the hip with Sinn Féin. Only the second ministerial visit by the new education minister, Weir, was one to an Irish language secondary school in Belfast, Coleachta Fearsta, which has received a £15.5 million extension from the department's coffers. This visit probably raises more questions than it answers. And unfortunately, the answers are not found in this draft programme for government framework. It beggars the question, what are the programme for government priorities for education? Will the 2016-21 mandate see further such investment? Will the people of Northern Ireland see a change in this education minister compared to the last education minister in regard to future decisions in relation to funding for new secondary schools? In particular, I refer to the supporting of the start-up of a secondary school with a first-year intake of only 14 pupils, just because it's an Irish language school. Will this new education minister go against any ministerial advisory group recommendations and seek personal or joint DUP Sinn Féin political agendas? While the last education minister was proud of taking politically biased decisions and going against the ministerial advisory group's recommendations in relation to a value for money decision, I am not sure that we're moving into a new era in education. None of these questions are answered in this draft programme for government framework, and neither have the actions of the education minister so far given me any confidence in this matter. Mr. Deputy Speaker, taking a look at the draft programme for government, one key outcome refers to the Department of Education. We give our children and young people the best start in life. Well, of course, who could disagree with that? But how do we achieve this outcome? So we look at the indicators, and numbers 15 to 11 refer specifically to education outcomes. Number 11, improving educational outcome, will be measured by the increase in the percentage of school leavers achieving at level 2 or above, including English and maths. But the unanswered questions remain. Are GCSEs the only method of measurement? And the chairman of the Education Committee, although he's not in his place now, referred to this earlier. Will they consider other qualifications? And more than that, are our young people actually job ready with these qualifications? Mr. Deputy Speaker, I nearly got excited when I read the heading Reduce Educational Inequality, indicator number 12. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I'm sure you recall in the last mandate of the Ulster Unionist Party's attempt to remove Article 71 of the Fair Employment and Equal Treatment Order 1998, the exception for schools under fair employment that allows them to discriminate in the employment of teachers on the basis of education, of religion. I thought for one moment that the Programme for Government framework might pledge to remove this fair employment exception, especially since all parties said, and it's recorded in Hansard, that they supported such a move. But no, that's not in the document. Indeed, the aspiration to improve educational outcome of those on free school meals is a commendable one, but there is no mention in the framework of looking at the free school meals measurement to assess if it remains a fair measurement of deprivation. And certainly there has been a lobby to do this. Indicator number 13, to improve the quality of education, again, is motherhood and apple pie stuff. Of course, we all want this. We also want the Education and Training Inspectorate to be changed, to be more effective, to work alongside schools in a better fashion, to enable schools to make improvements. There were a number of key recommendations in a previous Education Committee's report that so far have not been implemented. Indicator number 14 wants to improve the skills profile of the population by increasing their qualifications. But there is no mention of the particular problem of persistent underachievement within parts of Northern Ireland. Numerous reports have been published over the past 10 to 15 years identifying where this attainment gap exists. The research has clearly identified that, in particular, boys from a working-class Protestant background are doing significantly worse than girls from a middle-class Catholic background. I am surprised that such necessary target interventions are not mentioned. Initiatives like the Signature Projects in Numeracy and Literacy proved successful, but were cut in the previous mandate. Will these or similar make a comeback? We don't know this from the draft Programme for Government framework. Indicator 15, Improved Child Development, aims to measure an age 3 plus health review using ages and stages questionnaire in the Red Book, formerly known as the Personal Child Health Record. In contrast to the other indicators, this is something new and indeed is rather specific and focused. So for the executive ministers to use this argument that this document is only at a high level and doesn't get into detail is lost in this particular case. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I am disappointed that we stand today with only a framework rather than a detailed programme for government that was promised in the Fresh Start Agreement. You're going to tell me my time's nearly up. So in regard to educational indicators and outcomes, it is very high level and without specific detail. Where is the aspiration to break down the barriers between the many and varied sectors that make up our education system?
Your time, in fact, is nearly up now.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. There is no mention about breaking down the barriers and moving towards a single system. So while this framework is aspirational, it is lacking in central and overall vision, which is so badly needed for education. Thank you.
I call Andy Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I'd like to take this opportunity to congratulate those members who have made their maiden speech today, and I look forward to working constructively with them in delivering a better Northern Ireland for all our constituents. I welcome the opportunity to speak today as the Ulster Unionist Party's community spokesperson. And indeed, during the previous mandate, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I wasn't a member of this House for very long. However, like many, I watched as we leapt from crisis to crisis, whilst those who matter most, our constituents, suffered. Mr. Deputy Speaker, by 2020, it is predicted that one in four of our children in Northern Ireland will be living in poverty. If this executive does not address that, we will further fail our children. In 2012, OFM-DFM launched the Delivering Social Change framework, which stated, and I quote, "The framework has been established to deliver a sustained reduction in poverty and associated issues across all ages and to improve children and young people's health, well-being and life opportunities, thereby breaking the long-term cycle of multi-generational problems." However, according to most recent poverty bulletin, 23% of children were in poverty in 2013-14. That is approximately 101,000 children. That's an increase from 20% the previous year. 20% of working-age adults were in poverty in 2013-14, approximately 213 working-age adults. That is an increase from 18% the previous year. 21% of pensioners were in poverty in 2013-14, approximately 63% of pensioners. This is an increase from 20% the previous year. The last executive failed to deliver on key poverty targets, even though it went through a full process of listening to individuals, the community and voluntary sector, and leading academics. Do the two parties of government really expect the people of Northern Ireland to believe that this renewed listening to the same stakeholders who will be telling them the same things will create a policy portfolio that will address what should have been addressed over the last 4 years? In 2013, Homeless Charity Crisis carried out research which identified that Northern Ireland had higher rates of homelessness than any other region of the United Kingdom. Indeed, the latest statistics on the Northern Ireland Housing Executive website, there is 39,338 individuals on the housing waiting list, of whom 22,097 were considered to be in housing stress, including 11,016 households deemed to be statutorily homeless. This is simply not acceptable. Mr. Deputy Speaker, communities is a very large department with a wide range of functions. In addition to DSD, it has taken on many of the functions of DCAL. I know that many people are concerned that arts and culture may receive less priority in the new department, but I am determined that that should not be the case. Arts funding became a major issue in the last Assembly as budgets were cut and many groups faced severe difficulties. Prior to the election, the Ulster Unionist Party produced a policy document dedicated to the arts, and in our Assembly election manifesto, we committed ourselves to 5 points, not the only party that had a 5-point plan. As a key one was a lobby for the inclusion of the arts in the next PFG, outlining the executive's acknowledgement of the importance of the arts and demonstrating our commitment to them. Instead of entering this mandate with a clear strategy and set of policies that are already addressing the growing demands for social housing, tackling poverty and delivering for communities, we enter a new mandate with fluffy promises to make it better and calling on those who have already been talking to us to say some more. Just about to finish, you can come in a minute. Mr. Speaker, I will give credit where credit is due, and I will play my part as a member of the official opposition to ensure that those fluffy promises are turned into results which benefit those who need help the most. That's me finished. Go far away.
Anyway.
Yep.
Call Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
This morning when I woke up, I heard the death of a constituent, death the police were investigating. In the last hour, I've heard that was a member of Assembly staff. So I'd just like to put on record my condolences to the family. And if the initial suspicions of the police are true, I wish them every success in their investigation and catching whoever was responsible for the death, if it has been untoward. Deputy Speaker, I welcome the outcome approach of the draft programme for government framework. I think it is a progressive way of providing a holistic and long-term vision for Northern Ireland. The test is not what is in this document today. The test will be on what is to come. Because politics is not simply about what we want to achieve. I think you ask any person in the street, they'll want to see better educational achievement, better health outcomes, less preventable deaths. I think these things are things we can all subscribe to. The art of politics is in the how. How are we going to achieve these things? And we're not there yet in terms of this document. So it's right that this is a take note debate, because I think that's all we can do with this document. We can take note of it. The real substance will come in the action plans, and I hope a legislative timetable in terms of what we should expect to come forward from this executive in terms of how it can deliver on these outcomes. Mr. Atwood, when he spoke, talked about a hope of a paradigm shift and really following the Scottish model of being open, being, I suppose, an interactive government, of engaging with the wider community. And I hope for that too, but I have to say in that I'm not optimistic. My party was asked to meet with the First and Deputy First Minister in relation to the justice portfolio, and I thought quite reasonably I asked, well, can I see a draft of the programme for government? And I was told no. So if that's a signal, if that's a sign of how the type of engagement we're going to see from this government, I'm afraid the hope of a paradigm shift will not be lived up to. The First Minister also spoke about a spirit of cooperation, and members will be well aware that was something high on my agenda in the last Assembly, having brought forward the Children's Services Cooperation Act. And I do want to see us go beyond the legal requirement of government to work together for children, and to see a government that works together for the people of Northern Ireland as a whole. But it appears there's going to be no legislative requirement for that. And in fact, in the last mandate, we could not secure a commitment, a legal commitment, to have corporate governance. When John McAllister brought through his opposition bill, his plan had been that the government would be a single entity. And it concerns me that those now in power were resistant to that requirement. So what I'd be looking today from the First and Deputy First Minister is a commitment that we will not see a repeat of the embarrassment of ministers suing other ministers that we saw repeatedly in the last Assembly, including from the now First Minister. This was a cost not only to public finances, but a cost to the reputation of these institutions and our governance. We need to see corporate governance. We need to see a government that acts as one and is responsible for all decisions, not just those of their particular party colleagues. I welcome, Deputy Speaker, the commitment to equality in outcome three that's in this document. And again, the test will be in what actions are taken to achieve that equality, because equality is not simply ending discrimination, as is mentioned in the opening paragraphs of Outcome 3. Equality has to be about more than that. It has to be about inclusion. It has to be about rights protected within the law. And in that, we have a challenge to the parties of government. Are we going to see Minister Given bring forward the long-awaited sexual orientation strategy, which was promised in the last programme for government but not delivered? Are we going to finally see legislation for marriage equality brought through and passed through this Assembly? And I think we have to respect the mandate of the DUP, who went out in a manifesto that said they would not support such provision. But equally, I call on the First Minister and her party to respect the mandate of those of us who were elected with the commitment we would achieve marriage equality, and when that proposal comes back to this Assembly, that we will see no petition of concern, that we will see respect of that mandate, and more importantly, we will see a signal that we can have inclusivity in Northern Ireland. And the outcome three, a more equal society, is not just words, but something we can achieve in reality. And, Mr. Deputy Speaker, there's another commitment to increase environmental sustainability. And I'd like to express, I suppose, my optimism that that's in there, but the disappointment that the only measure seems to be the measurement of greenhouse gases. Absolutely fundamental, of course, but I can't stand over a commitment to environmental sustainability that says if you reduce greenhouse gases, it's okay if you pollute our rivers. We need something more holistic. We need genuine sustainability. And I do worry that all the talk about openness and well-being is undermined by the very opening purpose statement. Improving well-being for all by tackling disadvantage and driving economic growth.
Could I ask
growth.
The member to bring his remarks to
I
closure,
hope
please?
We will not, as we have seen in the past, an executive agenda driven by economic growth over everything else.
Now, as this is Mr. Gerry Carroll's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would just remind members in the House that it is convention, established convention, that he speak unhindered without interruption from others. I call Gerry Carroll.
Having read through the document at length over the weekend, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and having read through it again and again, I can't help but think that it's not a draft programme for government at all, but is in fact 114 pages of concentrated waffle, designed to deflect from an already pre-agreed programme of Thatcherite austerity. And there are plenty of aspirations in this document, many of which I would agree with, and no doubt many members in the House, in this chamber, would agree with. But in the end, the devil is in the detail, and action speaks louder than words. Take the aspiration to reduce poverty, for example. An important and laudable aspiration, but what does this mean in practice? We know, for example, that benefit cuts will increase poverty. We know that job losses will increase poverty. We know that the bedroom tax, which is coming in 2020, will increase poverty, and we know that all this is contained in the Fresh Start Agreement. So how can we reconcile the reality of an austerity programme like the Fresh Start Agreement with an aspiration to reduce poverty? The truth is, the executive cannot. Again, there is an aspiration in this document to improve mental health, and of course, everyone here in this chamber would welcome this. But how can we square this with a situation where in the areas with the highest levels of suicide and areas where they are most affected by issues associated with mental health, North and West Belfast, there is a disgraceful plan to close down mental health centres in these areas? What use is this aspiration to the users of Everton and White Rock mental health centres in Belfast? What's more, Mr. Speaker, how can any aspiration to reduce poverty or improve public services be reconciled by an economic plan taken straight from the Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan playbook? To reduce tax on corporations and to give big business handouts, the last 30 years of neoliberalism has taught us that there's no such thing as trickle-down economics. It doesn't exist and it doesn't work. In reality, the Fresh Start Agreement is a plan to send wealth upwards to the cost of hundreds of millions of pounds, which will be paid by the taxpayer and the public sector. There is, Mr Speaker, an alternative to this right-wing economics advocated by the executive. It's one based not on cutting the tax on corporations, but making the rich pay. It's an alternative that doesn't seek to set aside millions of pounds, as the Fresh Start Agreement indicates, to go after so-called benefit fraud, but instead sets money aside to go after the real fraudsters who avoid paying millions and billions of pounds in taxes. And there are more multi-millionaires per head of population in Belfast than in any other city here in the north or in Britain, except in London and oil-rich Aberdeen. And a socialist alternative, Mr Speaker, says make them pay. And why not abolish the rate system and replace it with a progressive local income tax where the rich pay the most, or at least remove the cap on rates on the wealthiest? Why don't we stop wasting hundreds of millions of pounds on wasteful PFI schemes? Why don't we end the wasteful voluntary redundancy scheme where £700 million is being set aside to put people out of work? Why don't we use £700 million to build homes and to put people in work? And it's not about a lack of money, Mr Speaker, it's about priorities. If it was about lack of money, then this House wouldn't have consistently afforded itself a pay raise when it was telling everyone else to take pay freeze or pay cuts. And this House has failed the vast majority of people here for too long. Now, we'd be very doubtful that this programme for government represents anything different. Indeed, the introduction to this document says that its progress cannot be judged in a single Assembly term, but rather can only be judged in a generation's time. Well, Mr Speaker, I want to make it clear that we don't have a generation to wait for this House to get its act together. Public sector workers, hard-working staff in places like the Royal Victoria Hospital don't have a generation to wait for the living wage. The LGBT community can't wait a generation to see its right to equal marriage granted. Those in child poverty won't even be children in a generation, and they can't be expected to wait either. Women who are being prosecuted because they want to control their own bodies can't wait for a generation. And the Irish language community, the pioneers of Bohor Shoy, or the thousands of people following in their footsteps in schools like College of Firstia, have waited long enough for their rights, and I'm sure they won't be prepared to sit back and wait to see if Stormont sorts things out in a generation either. And of course, the thousands of people who want to see a future free from sectarianism and communal bickering cannot be expected to wait a generation when they've already had to wait at least 20 years. I'd like to remind this House in closing, and anyone else that's watching, what Stormont does, people and the workers can undo. And even if the programme for government goes through, which it likely will, it won't be the end of the matter, because the day of reckoning is yet to come, and it's coming soon for the sturdy mongers on both sides of the chamber. Thank you very much.
I call Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. This document can only be described at best as synthetic and shallow. It's not about producing a programme for government. It's a mere collection of platitudes. It's an all things to all men manifesto, with no direction as to how it's going to deliver any of the platitudes. Of course, there's a very good reason for that. And the reason for that is that this is a government of irreconcilable differences. No surprise, then, that they postpone the producing of a programme for government. It's already been pointed out. Fresh Start told us this document was to be out in April 2016. And then the draft programme for government. And of course, 6 months later, all that is in reverse. And the reason it's in reverse is because this is a government incapable of agreeing its vision. And we know that through no better source than the First Minister. Because the First Minister told us all in her quest to be elected that it was imperative that she was elected Because Martin McGuinness, her partner, had a very different vision. She told her spring conference in Limavady, Sinn Féin would take Northern Ireland in the wrong direction. And now the terrible twins of DUP and Sinn Féin are in the position of having to try and produce a programme for government, knowing as they do that they are pulling in the opposite directions, that one wants to go socially, economically, and in other ways in one direction, and the other in the opposite direction. So no surprise to me that we have this synthetic, shallow document which doesn't answer any of the questions. This is a document with nothing on some of the key issues. We have the situation of education, where for years we haven't even been able to regulate within the ambit of government the transfer of our children from primary to post-primary. This document has no vision, no way forward on that. This document has nothing to say about cuts, about the austerity that the last speaker referred to. It sets out nowhere any sense of fiscal probity or fiscal direction. Why? Because they're pulling in opposite directions. And so it just goes silent on those issues. It has nothing to say about paramilitaries to any degree that matters. Maybe no surprise there. But if they want some indicators, and in this new world where we're going to judge things by indicators and match them against indicators, what about the indicator of Sinn Féin no longer being inextricably linked to the IRA? Would that be a good indicator as to whether or not paramilitaryism is being dealt with? Because the First Minister that told us that Sinn Féin, her partner, is inextricably linked to the IRA. So there's an indicator, if you want to take one, for whether any progress has been made on paramilitaryism. Or try another. Try the indicator that Sinn Féin at last admit that there is an IRA. Would that be a good indicator to tell us whether this coming together to address issues such as paramilitaryism is bearing any fruit? Or is it just okay within the ambit of this woolly, meaningless document that Sinn Féin can go on, even in the face of a report on paramilitaryism, can go on, and even in the face of the Chief Constable reaffirming his assessment of last autumn, that Sinn Féin can be part of this government pulling in whatever the direction's meant to be that this framework suggests, and still say, IRA? What IRA? There is no IRA. And the First Minister can tell us, well, there has to be, because her partner, Sinn Féin's, inextricably linked to the IRA, which her partner says doesn't exist. So just let them think of how they're going to square that circle on paramilitaryism. And when you begin to think about that, then you begin to see just how facile and how meaningless this document is. And finally, it is my hope that in 2.5 weeks' time, this document will require a major rewrite, because it will become a responsibility of this devolved assembly to play its part in the extracting of this part of the United Kingdom from the EU. And that we will not then need to think about policies where we will retake our fishing industry, where we'll have a department which will set the arrangements for fishing. Not much shadow or thought of that in this, where we will have departments having to prepare a bonfire of EU regulations.
Could I ask the member to bring his remarks to a close, please?
Because this is a document of meaningless platitudes.
I call Claire Bailey.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. And unlike many of my new colleagues at the Assembly, I'm not taking the opportunity today to make a maiden speech. I'll do that again, so I'll just make my comments brief. I think throughout this document, there is much mention of improving health, housing, respect, poverty, economic inequality, education. And throughout this document, there is much mention of various targeted demographics, such as children, disabled, youth, identity, and even paramilitaries, as I've heard in the discussion in this chamber several times today. These are all to be applauded and very noble sentiments, Deputy Speaker. But for me, the glaring omission in this document is women. Women are over half the population in Northern Ireland, yet still remain untargeted for commitments to improve inequalities levied upon them. For example, Indicator 7 states that we wish to improve health in pregnancy, yet this is only concerned with a baby's birth weight. This does not address a pregnant woman's health outcomes. If we are to wait, Deputy Speaker, for wider society to fill the blanks of this document, then I'm calling for wider society to take a very gendered view of what this programme for government should deliver over the next couple of years. I've watched over the past several years as consultation after consultation is responded to and those responses ignored. I've seen strategies put forward, written, and a lot of work, time and effort and money spent to produce them, then shelved, such as the childcare strategy. I feel if this programme for government ignores the role of women in Northern Ireland, if it makes no commitment to us, and given the work undertaken in the previous mandate, Deputy Speaker, or sorry, Mr. Speaker, I've changed. Particularly given our previous Speaker's commitment to good works and the creation of the Women's Caucus here in the Assembly. I really hope that within this mandate we can begin to address gender inequality in Northern Ireland with the urgency that it really deserves.
I call the Deputy First Minister to conclude and wind up on the debate.
Mr. Speaker. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I've listened very carefully to what has been an interesting and not too many times passionate debate, but I'm very pleased by the support shown by those who displayed it for the Executive's Programme for Government framework approach. As the First Minister said in her opening remarks, the approach and style of the next Programme for Government will be different. That is not to say that previous administrations were wrong to do what they did or that their actions and strategies were misguided. Much of the work started previously will continue and I have no doubt will find a place under the new programme for government. However, the difference this time will be that we will have a much clearer idea of what we want to achieve and will be in a better position to tell what is working and what is not. And we will also have a better picture of the things that we need to do, those things that will make a real difference, and to point out to those that we should be working with and supporting to take the important actions. By adopting the outcomes-based approach to the programme for government, the Executive has made some very significant statements of intent and ambition. It sets the bar high, at a high level, and commits the Executive to taking on the most difficult challenges facing our society. If something can make a difference to our societal well-being, it will be taken on. Where evidence demonstrates that efforts are not making a difference, we will be quick to alter course, to redirect resources towards more meaningful effect. The document we are debating today has been agreed by the Executive, but it is just the beginning. It is a draft programme for government framework. It is, as the name suggests, a structure for carrying more detailed programmes, strategies, actions and plans. As an executive, we are committed to improving public services, investing in our schools, our hospitals, our roads and protecting the most vulnerable in society. And this is against a backdrop of increasing pressure on public finances. So, as an executive, we need to be more creative and more joined up if we are to deliver for all the people. The new approach to developing a programme for government will allow the executive to rise to those challenges. Over the course of the next 3 months, the executive will formulate the work programmes it believes will deliver the outcomes contained in this framework. However, this will not be done in isolation, and ministers and their senior officials will want to use this period to take every opportunity to meet with stakeholders and potential delivery partners from all sectors to discuss and agree on the roles that they might be able to play to achieve our common goal. If I could just turn to some of the comments were made. I took a careful note of most of what people said. Obviously, given the time, I won't be able to cover everything. But obviously, the discussion really began in terms of the debate with the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party, who declared himself proud that he wasn't involved in the programme for government process. And of course he wasn't, because he left the government last year. Instead of standing with the rest of us to face down those who are still involved in criminality within our society, he took the coward's way out and took his party out of the executive. He would already say that there were two tests that they applied to whether or not they would be in government on this occasion. Both the tests have no credibility whatsoever in my eyes. The reason, in my view, that the Ulster Unionist Party didn't come into government was because of the election results. Absolutely nothing to do with the programme for government. If they had been returned with enough MLAs to have had three members sitting in the executive, or even two members sitting in the executive as ministers, they would be through the door and into the executive like a rocket. Didn't do that because the election didn't turn out the way he thought that it would. That was the only reason the Ulster Unionists didn't come in to the executive. He also talked about from 2011 to 2016 that the executive didn't deliver, and totally ignored the fact that much of the difficulties presented to the executive, which were mostly of an economic nature in relation to the massive cuts that were being inflicted on our executive by a Tory-led administration in London, was having a very dramatic effect on our department's ability to deliver, including the Department of Regional Development, which was held by the Ulster Unionist Party. And of course, the Ulster Unionist Party went into the general election of 2010 supporting the Conservatives, who then took those decisions. And it's quite rich, in my opinion, to try to blame the executive for the difficulties that were presented to us by the dramatic cut to our block grant. Christopher Stalford went on to talk about a very important issue in terms of how poverty affects people in communities. And I think that, you know, all of us recognise that improving health of everyone and ensuring we all have the best opportunity for people to live longer, including people in the Sandy Row, and indeed many other areas. You know, healthy lives is an obvious outcome for inclusion in the programme for government. And of course, there will be increasing demands on our health system, and the implications for our public finances make this one of the biggest challenges facing the executive. And as we all know, in terms of the international expert who has been invited to study our health service, and who no doubt will come forward with proposals that he hopes, and I think many of us would hope that all of the political parties could sign up to, that will make, hopefully, a dramatic opportunity for us to ensure that we consistently are in the business of improving our health service. So that is a major issue. Conor Murphy and Pam Cameron both mentioned the issue of how outcomes can help local communities, particularly people who are suffering marginalisation and disadvantage. And of course, that is very, very important. That outcome is about helping and caring for the most vulnerable in our society and ensuring that provision is adequate to meet their needs, but also by giving people the opportunity and the means to help themselves. And of course, somebody mentioned that there wasn't any mention of victims in the context of what we're trying to do, but an important dimension to all of this will be addressing the legacy of historical institutional abuse and the legacy of the past, and the needs of victims and survivors, and all our issues associated with our past. All of these are going to have to be tackled in the next term of this administration. Alec Atwood raised a number of questions in relation to the approach for the Programme for Government framework. He described it as a hybrid document. Well, the reality is that since November of last year, the SDLP had representatives attending all of the meetings that took place from the very beginning right through to the election. And I don't think any of the representatives, and I think most of the people who came were actually note-takers, I don't think they uttered a single word. I don't think they uttered a single word during the course of that conversation. And we got that from the civil service, from all our political parties who attended the meetings. And that clearly indicated to me from a very early stage, and I went so far as to ask for a meeting with the leader of the SDLP well in advance of the election to establish whether or not they were going to come into the executive. And he talked about it would depend on the outcome of the discussions around the programme for government. Yet here we had workshops, meetings, discussions, to which his party was invited, yet his party made little or no contribution whatsoever to those discussions. And it was then that the warning bells rang in my head. It was then that the warning bells rang in my head that the SDLP, in all probability, would not come in to the executive. And of course, why did they not come into the executive? For the same reasons as the Ulster Unionist Party didn't come into the executive. They did not get the result that they had hoped for. Came back to the Assembly with 12 members and decided, like the Ulster Unionist Party, in an act of desperation, that in order to change their political fortunes, not the fortunes of the people of the north of Ireland, that they would absent themselves from the executive and go into opposition. That's a reality. And of course, the SDLP have hooked their wagon to a political party that, even though it held the Department of Regional Development, was totally and absolutely opposed to the construction of the A5 road. And that is clearly on the public record. Alec Atwood also talked about, you know, people out in the community not being happy about the approach that was being adopted. Well, he certainly doesn't speak for Celine McStravick, who is the director of the National Children's Bureau for the North, when she said that the NCB is delighted that the Northern Ireland Executive has adopted an outcomes-based approach with its programme for government. She would also say this is an extremely significant change in how government will work, and it will, if operated correctly, ensure that programme for government policies deliver tangible results for the benefit of all. She goes on to say that for the first time, citizens will be at the centre of policy making. Departments will have to work together to achieve policy objectives, and there are important implications for the way the entire civil service will work. And to that end, the NCB has been heavily involved working with the executive to help bring this shift in direction, which is delivering great results across the world. And we look forward to aiding the executive with its aim of effective delivery and to therefore secure improved outcomes for children, families and for communities. I want to thank Naomi Long for her support for the process. I think she gave a very honourable approach in relation to her party. I think she gave a very clear and correct explanation of their party's understanding of the process and what was clearly the disingenuous approach of the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP. John O'Dowd, I think, gave us all a reality check, setting out the challenges facing our departments for the next 5 years as a result of the austerity agenda pursued by the Tory government in London. And isn't it amazing to hear, whenever people talk about the achievements or the lack of achievement from the Assembly and the Executive in the last term. Many times did you hear the British government mentioned in the course of this debate? From some of the most vehement critics of what we're trying to do. You know, the Executive is described as right-wing. The Executive is described as anti-children and anti-education, anti-health, anti-everything. When in reality, the people who hold the purse strings is the British government. And the British government, during the last term of the Assembly, that cut ruthlessly into our block grant. So I think there does need to be a reality check when people are looking at how we go forward, not just in relation to a recognition of that issue, but also recognising that when people, and the words motherhood and apple pie have been used here quite a number of times during the course of today, I hope people will come forward when they come forward with their ideas about how we improve life for our people, will come forward with costless proposals about how we do it. And it will be against the backdrop of recognising that we are still dealing with a ruthless Tory administration in London that is still committed to austerity. So I think reality check was important from John. Philip Logan from North Antrim mentioned the issue of jobs in Ballymena, and we all know that Ballymena, like many other areas, have been hit, but they've been hit very badly by job losses in recent times. Jenny Palmer from Niagara Valley talked about infrastructure. She actually mentioned the words vanity projects, and implicit in all of that was, you know, we need more roads east of the ban and not so many west of the ban. I don't accept that. And of course, as I say, the Ulster Unionist Party were in no way enthusiastic about what was a high-level north-south ministerial council project, and that was the construction of the A5. She did make other points in relation to the Balmoral Show, which has been a huge success, and access routes to the Balmoral Show, all of which I think are legitimate remarks. But, of course, many of the difficulties and the problems around the Mays Long Kesh site came from the fact that the Ulster Unionist Party lined up alongside the extremists within society who were opposed to the construction of the Peace Building and Conflict Resolution Centre on that site. Linda Dillon from Mid Ulster went on to talk about the need for environmental sustainability, how we deal with household waste, the issue of the need for good, high-quality jobs for rural dwellers, and the importance of the agri-food industry, as well as improving rural broadband to remove the inequalities that people who are rural dwellers suffer from. And of course, she made a vitally important point, and that is the relationship of this administration with the new super councils that have now come into being and are now 14 months old. Emma Pengilly from South Belfast talked about the need to tackle poverty and growing our economy, and quoted Muhammad Ali. And I think all of us who grew up with Muhammad Ali certainly not only believed he was a great boxer, but we absolutely believed that he was somebody that was totally, totally in favour of equality, coming as he did from a community in the United States of America that had been treated despicably for a very, very long time. So we remember him very fondly today. Claire Hannah talked about prickliness from government parties and talked about the fresh start. And again, proud that the SDLP were against fresh start. Not just against it, but voted against it in the executive. So what was the consequence of if we had voted against fresh start? If the DUP had not have gone for fresh start, well, I tell you what the consequence of that would have been. The direct rural ministers would have been in here the next day, imposing their water charges, removing the right to free prescriptions, removing the free travel for older people, and God knows what else. So that's the... Yeah?
the alternative to Fresh Start would have been to actually negotiate solutions to a lot of the issues that were ignored by Fresh Start. But the member critiques the lack of detail in our responses, but yet the outcomes-based approach with no detail is fine for you. You critique us hitching our wagon to the Ulster Unionist Party, who you claim are anti-building roads. Have you any differences with the party you've hitched your own wagon to? And finally, you criticise the process that we outlined to the electorate, that we would seek to negotiate a programme for government, and if it wasn't acceptable, we would go into opposition. You did that in the Republic. We did the same here. Can you outline, without recourse to the phrase enemy of the peace process, what is the difference between what you did in the South and what we've done here in choosing to use opposition to hold a failing government to account?
Well, I mean, you raised an awful lot of issues there during the course of that concise contribution. The reality is, no matter how you dress it up, if there had been no Fresh Start agreement and you were involved in the discussions that led up to it, the direct rule ministers would have been in here the following week and you would not be sitting in the seat that you're sitting in today. I would not, and neither would the First Minister, be in the positions that we're in today. So let's deal with the reality of what we had to deal with during the course of last year. And if we had followed the SDLP position, then there wouldn't have been no Assembly, there wouldn't have been no Executive, and the British Government would have had their fingers on the tiller here in the North. That's the reality. In terms of how we move forward, you know, we were criticised right, left and centre by the Ulster Unionist Party and by the SDLP during the course of the last administration. And we were effectively dealing with a situation where both parties wanted to have one foot in the government and the other foot out. One foot on the boat and one foot on the bank. And we know where that takes you. It takes you absolutely nowhere. And Colm Eastwood, during the course of his contribution, correctly talked about the fact that everybody in this House went out during the course of the election and talked to thousands of people and stakeholders about what they were offering up. And of course that debate was had. There were television debates, people had an opportunity to make judgments, and they sent the DUP back into this House with 38 seats. They sent the Ulster Unionists back into this House with 16. They sent us back to this House with 28 seats. And they sent the SDLP back with 12. So the people made their judgment, and they judged that they wanted us, with all of the difficulties and challenges and problems that we had during the course of the last term, to take our society forward. And I had always hoped that we could have done that, and that the SDLP, the Alliance Party and the Ulster Unionists would have been in that power-sharing executive, which was the central theme of the Good Friday Agreement. But of course that didn't happen. Barry Michael Duff went on to talk about education, the importance of literacy and numeracy, and the brilliant work that John O'Dowd did do in raising the levels of literacy and numeracy within schools, and the fact that there was a dramatic increase in the number of young people leaving with five good GCSEs. So I think he deserves credit for that. Stephen Furry talked about the issue of SIF. I remember whenever the SIF was first mooted, Alec Atwood described it as a slush fund for paramilitaries. Whatever about the challenges in a new innovative project, it was certainly no slush fund for paramilitaries. And the reality is that this was an attempt to empower local communities. And indeed, there are projects now up and running in local communities that are having an impact on poverty, that are having an impact on people who haven't had a job for a very long time, and also providing much needed amenities and facilities for local communities. So in terms of how we go forward, we also had a contribution from Doug Beattie from Upper Ban, and obviously all of us were very sad to hear of the tragedy in his family, and I think there's not a person in this House that wasn't totally sympathetic to his family at that time. But he raised the issue primarily, I suppose, of how we bear down on the activities of armed gangs and paramilitary groups that are still out there and who are still hostile to the peace process and clearly wouldn't like it to succeed. Well, we have received the report from the three-person panel, and that will go to our executive in the course of the next while. And that report deals with everything referenced in Doug Beattie's comments. So I think people will await with the outcome of that with some considerable interest. Declan McAleer talked about the situation in West Tyrone, and he made a very important point, which was articulated by others as well, encouraging people in society and in the community to become involved in this consultation. People who are involved in the community voluntary sector, different stakeholders, and just ordinary people who have an interest in how we go forward. And I renew that appeal. I think it's very, very important that we see as much involvement from the public in all of this. And Dahi Mackay rightly talked about family-friendly hours, but he made the same point about the public and stakeholders having their say. And, of course, he rightly challenged opposition parties to come forward with their costed proposals. And, you know, that's where the applehood and Mullerhood and apple pie is out there within opposition land. It's out there because people think they have the right to come in here and stand up and make all sorts of grandiose claim about why are we not doing this, why are we not doing that, you failed us in this, you failed us in that. Let's hear the proposals, let's see the costed proposals, and let's see how that fits into the budget that we as an executive have to deal with as a result of the challenges that we face coming from London and the fact that they have the ability to cut our block grant. Joanne Dobson dwelt on a range of health issues, and of course we do have a new health minister who is working against the backdrop of what will be hopefully very significant change as we go forward in this term, not least because of the challenges that will be posed to all of us by the outcome of an international report on the state of our health service. I've already mentioned Colin Eastwood, but he came after that. But I think the main point I made about Colin Eastwood was agreeing with him that we, all of us, spoke to the public against the backdrop of the relentless criticism of the DUP and Sinn Féin from the UP and the SDLP, yet the public, in their wisdom, decided to return us as the lead partners in this executive. Sandra Overend from Mid Ulster, I was quite shocked by her comments, which I thought was terrible and very unfair to young people who have been taught through the medium of Irish in Colaisha Fersha. For that to be the first point that she made in a criticism of the Education Minister's visit to that school, I think was shameful, and I think she should be embarrassed at that remark. Andy Allen talked about fluffy promises. There's nothing fluffy about what we're trying to do. What we are trying to do is give the public an opportunity to have their say, not a top-down approach. This is an attempt which has worked successfully in other places to ensure that there is an opportunity for the public to have a very meaningful input into the outcome of this programme for government. Stephen Agnew, in his contribution, mentioned the death of a member of Assembly staff, which I think shocked us all. Some of us have been sitting here for a couple of hours. We hadn't heard about it, but whatever the circumstances, I've no doubt that the First Minister and I and everybody in this House send their sympathy and condolences to the family who are obviously dealing with a very traumatic situation. And of course, he went on to talk about the important issue of equality. And in talking about the important issue of equality, there will be issues where the DUP and Sinn Féin will not agree, particularly in relation to issues like marriage equality. But these are all things that we're going to have to work through. I think we're all on a journey, and we all recognise that there is a duty and a responsibility on all of us to ensure that nobody within our society feels discriminated against. Gerry Carroll made his point that it was 114 pages of concentrated waffle, but he also went on to say that the devil is in the detail, and of course the devil is in the detail. And I think that it's unfair to use such terminology at this stage when we have yet to see the outcome of the consultation with the public. including the public in West Belfast and in many other parts of the North, who want to see us tackling the issue of poverty, who want to see us standing up for the most marginalised and vulnerable and disabled within our society. And I was quite taken aback at his information, which I certainly haven't got, that we'd have the bedroom tax here in 2020. We have made it absolutely clear that under no circumstances are we going to see our people, no matter what section of society they come from, have a bedroom tax imposed upon them. Jim Allister made his contribution, less said about that the better, and Clare Bailey went on to talk about the whole issue of the glaring omission being the position of women, but she did pay tribute to Mitchell McLaughlin for the creation of the Women's Forum, which has been a very important development within our Assembly. I said before the election, at the beginning of the month, that my priority was to bring forward and implement a programme for government that grows the economy, provides proper public services and promotes equality and inclusion. I also said that we need a government that works coherently and collectively, that we need equality and respect to be at the heart of how we do business. And I am pleased to say that the Executive's Draft Programme for Government framework does all that and more. It will enable us to prosper, to live longer, healthier lives, to have an equal society, to live sustainably, be innovative and creative, and to be a place where people can fulfil their potential. It will help us have more and better jobs, build safe communities, care for others, and provide help to those most in need. It will establish a basis for us to be a confident, welcoming and shared society that respects diversity, where we give our children the best start in life, and where we are all well connected by good infrastructure and a place where people want to live and work, and which is attractive to visitors and investors. It will also allow the executive to do things differently, work in a more joined up ways and engaging the stakeholders and delivery partners from every sector. When the full document is finalised at the end of the year, I am committed to the fact that it will not only be a programme that affects us all, but it will be a programme to which everyone can subscribe and which everyone can play a part. So, Mr. Speaker, I commend the draft programme for government framework and ask the Assembly to support the motion.